many ways due to COVID, but not having the All-Star game was really didn't have the start of high school football season. This is the kickoff to King football. We all get excited. About 3 or 4 weeks we'll be in earnest with the high school season, and just a great way to start the football season.
Of course, this is a game that both teams want to win, Ohio and West Virginia, and sometimes you might say, well, what are they playing for? Well, they are playing for something tonight. In fact, they're playing for the Bordas and Bordas Cup, and once again this year, we will have the presentation of the Bordas and Bordas Cup, and there's a look at the trophy right there. It'll be presented to the coach of the winning team immediately following the game tonight. He'll have his name added to the trophy, and it'll be placed in the OVAC Museum at West Banco Arena until the next All-Star game, when a new plate will be added each year with the winning coach's name and the score of the game as well. And we thank Bordas and Bordas for providing the trophy and for their great sponsorship of the OVAC All-Star football game. As we said, Bear, this is the 75th all-time meeting or all-time game being played. Ohio leads the series 45-28. There was one tie during this series, and the Buckeye State has won the last two in this series when they were played back in 18 and 19.
Yeah, and the two outstanding coaching staffs, and I really got to give some credit to both of these staffs. They were selected to coach in last year's game, and they didn't hesitate. When they were told they could coach again in 2021, they both jumped at the opportunity. Of course, Lindsay, this is their third experience. To the coach, to a man, just loved the experience. And, of course, for Fort Fry, it's their first time. But in talking to all the coaches down on the field before the game, they're just as excited as the kids. So great coaching staffs, great athletes. Should be a fun night of football.
Yeah, of course, B.J. Depew and his staff from Lindsay on the West Virginia side, and Eric Huck and his staff from Fort Fry on the Ohio side. And we'll talk more about the coaches as we continue to go throughout this game. Both of these coaches, of course, are longtime coaches at their schools. B.J.'s been the head coach at Lindsay for 15 years, served 7 years as an assistant under his dad, Terry. And Eric Huck's been the head coach at Fort Fry for the past 13 years. Of course, we have great sponsors that help us put this football game on each and every year. We want to check in with some of those sponsors throughout the night. And our first sponsor of the night is WVU Medicine. Let's go down to the field level and Dalton Haas to have more with that. Dalton?
Promo Glenn, number 76, Matthew Malik. And from Wheeler, number 77, Jordan
Brewing. Hi, fans. I'm down here on the sidelines with RJ DeCuba, sports medicine specialist from WVU Medicine Wheeling Hospital. RJ, WVU Medicine Wheeling Hospital provides support to the OVAC, not just with the athletic trainers on the sidelines, but also financially. They provide funding for over 12,000 student-athletes in our conference. How does this fall into your marketing strategy?
You know, the partnership helps us to, you know, really to spread the word about the importance of safety in sports, you know, really from childhood vaccinations all the way to cancer care. WVU Medicine has been at the forefront of providing health information to the community, and, you know, this partnership is just another one of those opportunities we get to really spread that information to the community as a whole.
All right. Well, thank you for being a part of the OVAC, and please know, fans, that we truly support the WVU Medicine Wheeling Hospital support, and we hope you enjoy the game tonight.
All right, Dalton, thank you so much, and we appreciate their support, that is for sure, and all that they do as well for sponsoring the Rudy Mumley OVAC All-Star football game. Of course, the teams are being introduced right now. We've had West Virginia already introduced, and now they are introducing Team Ohio. But folks, stay with us. We'll have more coming up in our pregame. Time for a break. Back with more of the 75th annual Rudy Mumley OVAC All-Star football game right after this.
Family Talk About Drinking is a program that helps parents talk to their kids about underage drinking. It's a community that allows parents to learn new ideas and ask questions about how to tackle the problem of underage drinking. Family Talk About Drinking, presented by WTOV9, the OVAC, and your local Anheuser-Busch distributors.
We're doing exciting things at the WVU Heart and Vascular Institute in advanced heart failure and valvular heart disease. In atrial fibrillation, and even heart transplantation. We know that if patients can achieve advanced care in their home community, they do better. We provide the entire spectrum of care, and our outcomes are amongst the best in the nation.
Visit mywvuheart.com. As the Ohio Valley has changed, so has Belmont College. For new jobs in a shifting economy, for the first step towards a bachelor's degree, for new ways to connect to learning. For Alyssa, for Jason, for Houston, for our community. For the last 50 years and the next 50, Belmont College, celebrating 50 years of education.
And welcome back once again, everybody, to Wheeling Island Stadium as we are continuing here with the introductions of all the players before the 75th annual Rudy Mumley OVAC All-Star Football Game. And the 2021 Rudy Mumley OVAC All-Star Football Charity Classic is being presented by Huntington Bank. And is also being brought to you in part by several other sponsors, including AB Distributors of the Ohio Valley, Huntington Bank, West Liberty University, and by WVU Medicine. And Bear, this is really part of the pageantry that is so great about this game is you look down on the field right now and you see the players being introduced, the band's there, the Queen of Queens, and this is truly what it's all about right now.
Yeah, it's a great representation of Ohio Valley Athletics. You know, the Queen of Queens adds so much to this event, and of course the McDonald's band, I've been told some people come to the game just to watch the band, so that speaks highly of the quality band that's going to be on the field here tonight.
Absolutely, and of course, this is the 40th year of sponsorship by the local McDonald's restaurants of the All-Star Band. A shout out to the local McDonald's restaurants, Mr. Ross Stoltz and his family, and all they do for the folks of the Ohio Valley and for sponsoring this band now for the last 40 years.
Just incredible.
And you can see the crowds continuing to fill in here as well at Wheeling Island Stadium. Looks like we're going to have a decent crowd here tonight. See the far stands. The sun's starting to go down a little bit over in the west. But you can tell that people are excited. They're ready for high school football once again here in 2021. That is for sure.
Yeah, and I think the fans just don't know what to expect here tonight. We've got a great contrast in styles. West Virginia comes out. They're pretty speedy. They're going to open up the field. Ohio on the other side, I think we're going to see a little bit of wing T, the old wing T, Scott. They're going to try to pound it out. Their roster is huge. We'll talk about that throughout the evening. But Coach Huck did an outstanding job selecting this team for Ohio, and they're on a mission to run the football.
And it's because you said, Barrett's going to be that dominating running game of Team Ohio against the speed of Team West Virginia. Which one can win out? We'll talk a little bit more about that as we continue to get ready for tonight's game here at Wheeling Island Stadium. But it's now time for the playing of our national anthem here at Wheeling Island Stadium. And we will be heading down to the field once again. One of your first opportunities to hear the McDonald's All-Star Band as they will be performing the national anthem.
Anthem, we'd like to have a prayer led by Pastor Champ Holberg.
Lord God, we thank you for continuing to bring us out of the storm of the COVID-19 pandemic and blessing this land you have given us. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. We thank you for answering our prayers and for the love and care of those who assisted others, and for those who continue to help your children during this difficult and challenging time. Thank you, Lord, for caregivers, doctors, nurses, hospitals, therapists, teachers, police, firefighters, EMS workers, church and community leaders, and for support of mothers and fathers. Thank you for the most valuable gift of all, your mercy and forgiveness called grace. Please protect your children, dear Lord, and all who travel this day. We ask for your continued healing for those who are sick, who are having surgery, and those being rehabilitated. We ask for your comfort for all who are grieving the loss of a loved one. And Lord, we thank you for the gift of this new day and another opportunity to enjoy your creation and to share your love. In Jesus the Christ's name we pray, amen.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, let us honor America with the Star-Spangled Banner performing the national anthem.
Please welcome the 2021 OVAC All-Star Band.
Wonderful performance of the national anthem by the McDonald's OVAC All-Star Band. That's the thing, Bear, that I really enjoy about this game so much is you have all-stars in all different facets. We've got all-star football players. We've got all-star coaches. We have all-star band members. When these kids just came together this week, there they are marching. They just played the national anthem together. I mean, that's not something that's simply done. You know, you got the all-star cheerleaders. It's a special thing to see all these kids come together like this and perform the way they do.
Yeah, they played that anthem about as well as any collegiate band I've heard. So just great job and kudos to the band and, of course, McDonald's, our sponsor.
Now, of course, throughout the season, we will have our OVAC Rivalry Series that will be going once again this year in 2021. And taking a look at that OVAC Rivalry Series for this year, it promises to be another great season in our partnership with WKKX. And these games will air on WKKX 1600 AM or on 1370 AM WVLY and audio streamed on WKKX.com during the upcoming football season. The schedule is comprised of a good balance of games from smaller and mid-sized and big conference schools. The Rivalry Series will kick off on Friday, August the 20th, with Martins Ferry visiting Shadyside. And then the following week, you can see the Tigers take on, or listen to the Tigers take on Wheeling Central, and then St. Clairsville and AC Rivalry Series on WKKX and WVLY, presented to you by West Liberty University and the Watchdog Network.
Got to give a shout-out to my man Larry Ryan as the honorary referee for tonight's game. Larry's a veteran official, 30 years in the Ohio Valley Board, and he just retired a few years ago, and he's going to toss the coin. So shout-out to my good man Larry Ryan.
Yeah, it's great to visit with him before the game. We had an opportunity to talk to him down there on the sideline, and seen before he headed out there onto the field. And yes, he's going to be out there to toss the ceremonial coin before the game. Of course, Sam Jones is our referee of the game tonight.
Yeah, Chicken, as they call him, has been a veteran official of 34 years, and I think this is his third time he's done the All-Star game. So shout out to my man Chicken.
We'll see. I'm not sure if we'll be able to get the call of the coin toss or not from Chicken Jones or not, if he'll have his microphone turned on here for the announcement, but we'll see if we can listen in as he's shaking the hands of all the players, the captains for both Ohio and West Virginia. West Virginia going with, of course, five captains, in Ohio with three.
Yeah, the captains for tonight's game for Ohio, Will Balgo, Reese Skaggs, both from St. Clairsville, Evan Carpenter, Martins Ferry, Reimer from New Philadelphia, Bo Heller and Stevie Mitchell from Wheeling Park, Dalton Flyers from John Marshall, Hunter Kelly, who is injured and will not play this evening, injured in a freak accident at practice the other day, and then DeAndre Crudup from Morgantown. Talking to coaching staff, really unfortunate. It was a little one-on-one drill. They do it every practice.
Yep.
Virtually no contact, but he just slipped and was injured, and unfortunately will not be in uniform. Just an outstanding athlete in all three sports.
Contest, the referee, Sam Jones.
And we've had the coin toss here.
Eric Hayden. Chase Marshall.
See.
Rick Moore.
Looks Shane like Ohio. Henderson. So Ohio won the toss. Let's see. Let's see what we get from Chicken here.
The Mountaineers have won the toss, and they will receive.
There we go.
While we got a moment, let's talk about the officials. Of course, referee Sam Jones, linesman Glenn Perdue from Steubenville, line judge Eric Hayden, also from the WVO board. Eric lives in Weirton. Side judge Ricky Moore from Rayland High. He's a member of the High Valley board and a member of my crew, so got to give a shout out to my main man, Ricky. And the back judge is Shane Henderson, who is from Wellsburg and a member of the WVO board. Field judge will be Robert Powell.
All right, Bear, time now for our CA House Music keys to the game. And really, Tom, they're pretty simple, aren't they, when you look at this game?
Yeah, everything I've read and I've talked to both coaching staffs throughout the week, back on Monday and Tuesday and again today, and there's no doubt about what's going to happen. Fort Frye runs the wing tee offense. They love to run the football. I asked Coach Huck, how often will you run it? He says, well, during the season, we like to run about 85% of the time. He said, tonight we'll be happy with 80% if we can be successful running the football. They selected their team with size, both at the tight end, the fullback, and all their linemen are huge. So they want to run the football. Western, on the other hand, realizes they're undersized. They need to play in a wide-open field. They want to get the ball out in time and space, and they got some great athletes. The speed advantage definitely goes to West Virginia. They need to get the ball out in the open field, and the same way, they need to run the football, but they want to do it in the open field. So that'll be the matchup. James Wall has summarized it for me entirely. He said, if this game's over at 9:30, we're in big trouble. He said, if we extend it towards the 11 o'clock hour, he said, I like West Virginia's chances. Of course, he's the defensive coordinator for West Virginia.
Yeah, we'll see what which part of James's prediction comes true here tonight. Joel Chevalier from Warren is our kicker who will kick things off and get it started here as Ohio will kick off and back deep for West Virginia. We have Sincere Sinclair on the near side for West Virginia, and he will be the man who will come down with the football at his own 5-yard line. Able to stay on his feet, looking to get outside. Sinclair turns it back up inside, and Ohio does a good job to corralling quickly at about the 15-yard line. Good job there. I see Jake Visnick, number 5 from Shadyside, who was in on the tackle that time for the Buckeyes. So it'll be 1st and 10 for West Virginia, starting on their own 15-yard line.
Yeah, early in the game, we need to watch this secondary for Shadyside, how they cover the receivers, because you're going to look for West Virginia to dink and dunk the ball. They're probably going to throw it out in the flat, try to make a 5-yard play into a 70-yard touchdown.
Of course, Bo Heller is the starting quarterback for Team West Virginia, and what a senior campaign he had at Wheeling Park. Completed 75% of his passes, threw for nearly 1,700 yards, and had 23 touchdowns in Bear. That was in 8 games. They only played 8 games and were not able to play in the postseason. Heller to pass on 1st down, has his man, and the pass is caught by Kobe Hill. Lindsley's Kobe Hill pulls that in for a gain of 15 yards all the way up to the 30-yard line.
I'll tell you, what a versatile athlete. Little Kobe's great baseball player, and filled in admirably as the backup quarterback for Lindsay this year.
Yes, he did.
And if they go to a backup quarter tonight, Kobe may get the role.
1st and 10 again for Team West Virginia. Heller looks like maybe a bit of a broken play, but able to stay on his feet and gets the ball out to Hill again. It'll be a gain of about 4 yards up to the 34-yard line. So turned what might have been a busted play into still a gain of 4 on 1st down. It'll be 2nd and 6.
I always say Bo Heller was the greatest JV quarterback ever seen. He patiently waited his turn through his junior campaign, and he stepped in senior year, 73.5% completion. That is unbelievable, Scott. It's a park record, and they've had some great quarterbacks.
Yes, they have. Yes, they have. His dad, of course, one of them, and we'll talk more about that story as well, because fathers and sons that have both played in this game. Heller to the air and complete once again, and there's a penalty flag that comes in there late. It's going to be a 1st down, though, for West Virginia. Anthony Sessi was the man with the reception that time.
We'll wait for the indication by the referee, Chicken Jones.
Maybe a face mask late? Let's see.
I would guess that would be the call.
Personal foul, face mask, defense, number 28, 15 yards from the end of the run, 1st down.
There you go, Bear. You had it.
If you're West Virginia, this is a start you want. Moving the football,
yeah,
wide open game. And
yeah, they're get a penalty. I mean, that's what you have to avoid. Penalties and turnovers in this game are what dictate the winner and loser a lot of times. There's no doubt about that. So 1st and 15 for Team West Virginia from the Ohio 41. Jordan Waterhouse is the tailback from Wheeling Central, and they'll toss it to him. Waterhouse makes the catch. He's over the 40 and down to about the 35-yard line is where he's finally forced out, a gain of 6. And, you know, Heller and Waterhouse, even though they played at separate schools, they got a great history between the two of them. They've been childhood friends.
Yeah, we'll get into that later. There's nine players in this game, six West Virginians, three Ohioans, that actually played Little League baseball from the age of, or travel baseball, from the age of 9 to 14. We'll talk about them later, but those two guys have been longtime teammates, longtime friends, more
That's
importantly.
Right. Second down at about 6 now for West Virginia. They'll throw the middle screen. It's Waterhouse again. He's got a first down and more, and down to about the 25-yard line for West Virginia. Looks like they'll officially mark him at about the 24. So another pickup of good yardage there for Team West Virginia. Gain of 11, and it'll be first and 10 from the 24-yard line of Ohio.
Of course, Chris Kedas is the offensive coordinator for the Cadets. And
pretty good quarterback in his own right.
Quarterback that Lindsay, pretty outstanding. Played a little bit up at West Liberty, and he's dialing up all the right plays right
you
now.
You know he likes to throw the football, and so does Bo Heller. Heller again to the air, got a man in the end zone. It's just a little bit too far for Kobe Hill. He had a couple of receivers there as well. Gage Patterson from Oak Glen, number 12, was also in the vicinity, but they had gotten behind the defense that time. They were open. The ball was just a little bit overthrown, so it'll be second and 10 from the 23.
Talking to the coaches throughout the week, they had a lot of superlatives about a lot of these players, but Gage Patterson was one that they really were high on. You're going to see a lot of that kid on the field tonight.
Great speed from Patterson, and if you did not see Oakland play last year, you're going to enjoy watching him play tonight, that's for sure. Here's Heller again, second and 10, again to the air, over the middle, and it is incomplete. Hard hit put on there by Dylan Moore on the intended receiver that time for Team West Virginia was Levi Rice out of Parkersburg South, and he got knocked pretty good that time by Moore as he came across and leveled him pretty solid there.
Yeah, we expected that Dylan would show up on the offense side of the football, but here he's in the starting defensive lineup, so you're going to see a few of these kids go both ways, although most of the teams will try to play as many players as possible.
Well, after moving the ball pretty well, West Virginia's been stalled a little bit. It's now 3rd and 10 from the 23-yard line. Heller takes the snap. He's going to roll and stay on his feet and just overthrows his intended receiver, Anthony Sessi, out of Madonna. Had him, would have been a first down, but the ball is just a little bit overthrown, and it'll lead to a West Virginia field goal attempt as Joe Lima from Lindsley will come onto the field and will be trying a 41-yard field goal.
DePue says he has about a 47-yard range, so this is well within his range, and Joe Lima, what an athlete. We'll talk about him later. Not just a football player. He was a outstanding swimmer, outstanding track man for the Cadets, and
officially from the 30, so it'll be a 40-yard field goal. The snap, the hold, the kick is up, and it is just good. It sneaks over the crossbar. So from 40 yards, yes, Joe Lima is good. And West Virginia gets on the scoreboard first on our Huntington Bank scoreboard. It's now 3-0 West Virginia with 9:24 still remaining here in the opening quarter. So West Virginia Bear gets the ball. They start on their own 15-yard line. They're able to take it all the way down to the Ohio 23, and they get points out of it.
It's really nice to have an outstanding kicker that you can get those 3 points on board. That was a good drive, and it would have been wasted without any points. So Joe Lima, as I said, Coach DePue said he might have been the best athlete at Lindsley this year, and that's saying something because they had a ton of outstanding athletes. But he said the young fella is just, you know, like I said, he was an OVAC swimming champion,
yep,
was on the OVAC track team that won the couple of the events over at the OVAC. So, and just a personable young man, too.
You see on our Belmont College replay there, that ball just got over the crossbar, but hey, that's all it has to do. It was long enough. If it had been from 41, I don't know that he would have gotten it, so good thing they marked it at the 30, and he kicked it from the 30. 41 might have just nicked that crossbar, and it might have fallen back into the end zone.
Coach DePue did say that Joe Lima's real strength is on the kickoffs, that he's very capable of the kickoffs. He hangs them up for pretty good, and allows the team to get down and cover.
Well, we're about to see that now here as he will tee it up at his own 40-yard line. Back deep to receive for Ohio. Garrett Dozier is to the near side. Looks like Dylan Moore is there in the middle. And on the far side, looks like that might be Reese Skaggs possibly. Or no, Jake Rose, I think, from River. No, it's 24, excuse me on that, folks. That's Jeremy Brown from Indian Creek. A little muddle huddle there. Who has it? Well, it's Moore coming out through the middle. He's got some space. Moore, those slips over the 30-yard line and gets it up to the 33. You got to love All-Star games, right,
Scott? That was going to be my words exactly. Here's a coaching staff, Fort Fry, pretty conservative. They're not pretty conservative.
They are.
They're real conservative, and they come out with a trick play right off the bat, so you never know in All-Star games. So, hats off to Eric Huck and his staff for coming out with a little trickery right off the bat.
And our Belmont College replay right there showed you that little trickeration that they opened with, and get some pretty good field position too. They'll start at their own 33. St. Clairsville's Tyler Tomkovich will get the start at quarterback. They will play three quarterbacks tonight, however. Handoff there will go to Matt Schaefer, and nowhere for him to run. West Virginia's defense does a great job running the Indian Creek Redskin down from behind, and that's going to be a loss of about 3 yards on first down.
Talking to coaches, of course, they have superlatives about all the players on the field, but in talking to Coach Huck, he said that Schaefer and Carpenter really stood out in practice and expect those two guys to have big games.
It's now second down and 14. Ball's officially on the 29-yard line. Evan Carpenter's the tailback of this offense. Wingbacks are Schaefer and Garrett Dozier out of Toronto, and we've got a penalty flag on the field.
Yeah, it looked like we had a little leaning there in the backfield. And that's always tough, Scott. You only have 1 week to prepare.
Right.
And, you know, especially with the wing tee, that's not a real simple offense to put in.
Not.
So it would be interesting to just see how well they can execute.
So Ohio now faced second down and 19. So on back-to-back plays, they've lost yards, lost it on first down due to West Virginia's strong defensive effort, and then cost themselves 5 yards this time. Well, this time they're going to go with just a single wing back and two wide receivers to the near side. Tomkovich under center. Looks like he fumbled the football. He did, and I think West Virginia has it. They think they have it as well. And what does Sam Jones say? Yes, they do. Ohio fumbles the snap, and West Virginia is on it and recovers it. Looks like getting off the bottom of the pile is Devin Gaines from Parkersburg South.
Red ball, third down.
Oh, they're saying no, that Ohio did recover it. And so Ohio will keep possession of the football, and it'll be third down. See if we can see here on our Belmont College replay. You see the ball was loose. Hard to tell there, obviously. And you know, Tom, from being out there, and the ball was still loose there.
Still loose.
And you know, as being out there as a longtime official, a lot of grabbing and all that goes on underneath those piles. You never know who has it until you pull the last guy off.
Those are tough. Anything goes.
And the ball was still loose. I didn't see that initially, but saw it there on the replay.
Yeah, one of the big linemen came out holding the football for Ohio, so I think it was the correct call.
Well, now this wing T offense is going to have to look at more being a spread offense here on third and long. Tomkovich will roll, looking downfield, still rolling and still looking, getting pressured by West Virginia, and he will just take the sack. Dalton Flowers of John Marshall in on the tackle that time for West Virginia, and so it will bring up fourth down. You know, hey, a lot of coaches will tell you, look, I'd rather punt than have an interception, right? So
exactly.
Tomkovich didn't have someone to go to. He elected to just go ahead, take the sack. They'll punt it back to West Virginia.
Yeah, talking to James Wallace during the week, he said, this Dalton Flowers, he said he's a football player, and whenever they try to run the jet or run wide, look for Dalton to be Johnny on the spot.
He was a great offensive player for John Marshall as well. He carried the ball a lot, caught the ball out of the backfield, just a good athlete in general. For the Monarchs during his career there, and especially this past year during his senior campaign. Well, Chevalier's into punt now out of Warren and back deep to receive. Gage Patterson from Oak Glen. Patterson will go back to about his 30-yard line where he makes the catch, and that's it. Nowhere to go after that. Great tackle. Dylan Hart, one of the five Fort Fry cadets that are on the roster, makes the tackle, and West Virginia will start first and 10 with the ball on their own 29-yard line.
Of course, Dylan was a two-time All-Ohio performer for Fort Fry that had two undefeated regular seasons, and he's going to head to Glenville State, play a little football, and outstanding performer.
Good coverage there, as you see it on our Belmont College replay. Jake Rose was the first man down there to really kind of slow Patterson up, and he really had no opportunity to try to get away. So West Virginia starts their second drive of the game on their own 29-yard line. They lead 3-0 on our Huntington Bank scoreboard. Bo Heller again in the gun. Low snap. It goes through Heller's legs, and Bo will just do well enough to go back and recover it at the 14-yard line. So a loss of 15 yards on first down.
As you would expect in an All-Star game, execution offense been a little tough for both teams.
Yeah, we're going to see that. Here it is again on the Belmont College replay. Heller, though, does a smart thing. Doesn't try to pick it up and make a play with it. Just go get the ball, recover it, and live to play the next down.
Interesting enough, this defense for Ohio has three starters from Fort Fry. So not only do they have their offensive package, they definitely have their defensive package in there, too.
So it's second down and long now. Ball officially on the 16-yard line. They'll throw the screen, and the pass is caught and pulled in, but not much doing there at all that time. For Team West Virginia and Kobe Hill, as he was tackled quickly by Ohio.
Yeah, that was real nice pursuit there by Brady Kucherenko, 6'2", 225, out of Fort Fry. And that's nice when your lineman can run down the wide receiver. We're getting a little break in action here, Scott, for a little hydration.
Absolutely, and we're going to take a break as well. 6 minutes remaining, 5:48 to be exact here in our opening quarter. On the Huntington Bank scoreboard, West Virginia leads 3-0. Back with more first quarter action right after this.
Max Camilleri. From Barnesville, Sidney Carpenter. From Madonna, Kelsey.
We're doing exciting things at W. Heart Vascular Institute. In advanced heart failure, in valvular heart disease, in atrial fibrillation, and even heart transplantation. We know that if patients can achieve advanced care in their home community, they do better. We provide the entire spectrum of care, and our outcomes are amongst the best in the nation.
Visit mywvuheart.com.
Introducing Standby Cash. Extra cash when you need it. Free when you auto pay it back. New when you bank with Huntington.
These are the things that push us forward, that motivate us to win. Community. Family. Experience. Results. These are what make Bordas and Bordas champions of justice. Bordas and Bordas, fighting for justice.
And we're back once again at Wheeling Island Stadium. 5:48 remaining in the first quarter. West Virginia leads 3-0. Let's go back down to the sideline and more with our sponsors and Dalton Hawes. Dalton?
Earlier access to your pay. An extra cash on hand standby. This is how Huntington reinvents banking. Earlier access to your pay. An extra cash on standby. Welcome to Huntington.
All right, folks, back to the action now here at Wheeling Island Stadium. West Virginia with a 3rd and 23 on the 16-yard line. Heller rolling, looking downfield, pressured, and gets it off, and it is caught. Or yes! Oh, what a catch on the far sideline from Team West Virginia. And who else but one of his own teammates, Carson Namak, out of Wheeling Park, who made several outstanding catches like that during his career with the Patriots and this past season from Heller.
I was just getting ready to say there's not many 3rd and 23 plays you can run, but obviously Bo Heller dialed one up there. Great catch, 30-yard gain.
Fantastic. So they get out of the deep pressured area there, and they move the ball out to the 46-yard line. 1st and 10 for West Virginia. Heller again. He'll ride it in and will give it off to Waterhouse, who will gain a couple of yards. Up to about the 48-yard line. So a gain of 2 on first down, and it'll be 2nd down and 8 now for Team West Virginia.
Yeah, you needed to run it up the middle just once or twice just to keep him somewhat honest.
Loosen, yeah, a little bit right there. Yeah.
Just to make him think that you might run it there.
So 2nd and 8 for West Virginia. Heller again. Trips to the near side for Team West Virginia here on this down. Heller throws a quick one out, and it's pulled in again by Namak on the far side for Team West Virginia. Gain of about 7 or so, 6 on the play. This is going to be 3rd and still 2. 3rd down and 2 now for Team West Virginia from the Ohio 46-yard line.
One nice thing is on that play, Heller had 3 of his Wheeling Park teammates out wide. Mitchell, Namak, and Sincere. So he's certainly familiar with those receivers.
Yeah, I mean, they can go 4 wide and have Heller in there and have Hall, Wheeling Park athletes. They move Kobe Hill in at quarterback now. And Heller goes split out wide. Hill will just keep it himself, looking for a block. Gets it, and he gets a little seam and picks up the first down for Team West Virginia. Down to the 41-yard line. So a gain of 5 yards on 3rd down there for West Virginia. And they move the sticks once again. And you see West Virginia, a little trickeration there too, Bear, if you will, but using their skilled players in certain ways. And look at this setup now as they go wide, and we've got a penalty flag. Maybe somebody was not on the line of scrimmage, or we had too many men in the backfield because they put one of their lineup, lineman Jordan Bruick, was out there.
See what dead chance. Ball, encroachment on the defense, number 60. 5-yard penalty. First down.
Well, there you go. So encroachment on the defense. So West Virginia picks up 5 yards. Boy, Ohio not helping themselves with penalties. They had the fumbled snap that they did get back. And then now West Virginia moving the ball well once again. It was a big penalty on that first drive that helped keep that alive for West Virginia. And West Virginia's made a couple of big plays on this drive now too. First down and 5 for Team West Virginia. Here's Heller. Plenty of time to throw it. Looking downfield, and it is nearly intercepted, but tipped by there by Dylan Moore of Ohio as he was going for Shahid Jackson. His Wheeling Park teammate had him. Maybe led him a little bit more. Might have been a touchdown. Jackson had gotten behind the defender, but Moore makes a great play on the ball there to knock it incomplete.
Yeah, the little guy, Dylan Moore from Beaver Local, headed to Geneva to play some collegiate football and showing up on both sides of the ball.
Yeah, he's made some big plays already for Team Ohio on the Belmont College replay. You see it there once again. Good tip by him. Aiden Hannes from Barnesville was also in on the play, too. So it's second down and 5 now for West Virginia. Ball is on the Ohio 36, and we've got another penalty flag. See what this is.
Dead ball, false start. Offense, number 7. 5-yard penalty, second down.
All right, so West Virginia hurting themselves there with a penalty, so it'll move it back to the 41, and it's now second down and 10.
Of course, the no-huddle offense, Scott, really keeping Ohio a little bit off guard.
Heller again to throw, looks out, has his receiver, that's Stevie Mitchell from Park. Mitchell makes the catch, and he's close to another West Virginia first down.
Of course, Mitchell was an outstanding running back for the Park.
Mm-hmm.
A little small, only 5'7", but the coaching staff from Lindsay wants to get him out in the open field. They feel like he can really make things happen, bust that big play.
He had an outstanding career at Wheeling Park. Of course, was also a state champion wrestler for the Patriots as well last year at 145 pounds in Class AAA. All right, it's third down and about a yard here. Heller in the gun, has Waterhouse behind him. Pressure from Ohio, but Heller gets it away, and the pass is pulled in and caught on the far side for a first down for West Virginia. And that's Steve Felton from Lindsley, who comes in at the tight end position, and, boy, makes a catch.
We're going to have a lot of different receivers for West Virginia. They have a lot of receivers on the roster, and it looks like they're going to take advantage of all of them.
West Virginia three wide again to the near side, and again they'll send Heller into motion. He'll go out and line up wide, and now Hill will come in at quarterback of West Virginia with some movement on that offensive line.
False start.
1, 2, 3.
Offense.
One, two, three.
Can they hear number 52. Them, 5-yard penalty.
One,
first
two, three,
down.
1, 2, 3.
Now that
one,
might
two,
happen
three.
When you're switching different one, quarterbacks, three, right?
Linemen hate this rule where the referees allowed to announce their name and number.
Right?
Number, I should say.
It's the only time you hear a lineman's number, right? Is when they've
one,
done
two,
something
three,
wrong.
1, 2, 3.
Yeah,
one, two,
you
three.
Feel bad for those guys.
One reason
two, three,
I wasn't
one,
in favor
three.
There on high school level, but
one, two, three.
It's come to stay in the game.
Now it's first and 15. Now Heller to the air, looking downfield, has his receiver, and it is just dropped by Gage Patterson. Patterson nearly able to run that down. Boy, that ball was laid in there nicely by Heller. I mean, that was a strong 45-yard pass by Heller into the end zone that just falls incomplete.
Yeah, that ball was in the air every bit of 45 yards and shows that Heller does have some strength in that arm.
So it'll be second and 15 now for West Virginia. And there's a look at the Belmont College replay. You can see that just off the fingertips of Patterson. Now on second and 15, Heller again, got some pressure. He's going to get the ball up, and it is incomplete. Stevie Mitchell trying to make the catch on the near side. He was well defended. There's Dylan Moore
once again
in
I'll
on the play
you,
for
he,
Ohio, and Logan Mobilini was also in on the play from Cambridge.
I'll tell you, Dylan Moore is around the football.
Yes, he is.
When you see the ball in the air, expect number one to be somewhere in the vicinity.
I mean, you talk about playing free safety. He's doing a great job with that, roaming and just finding the football all the time.
Yeah,
so third and 15 now, Bear. What do you do here if you're West Virginia? Well, they're going to run a little screen, and that ball's going to go to Shahid Jackson, and he's not going to go anywhere. In fact, he's going to lose some yardage. Mobilini's in on the tackle, and, I see Moore was around the ball once again.
They throw it 20 yards downfield. He's in the vicinity. They
right?
throw in the backfield. He's
My
there.
My goodness.
So certainly a nose for the football by Dylan Moore.
B.J. DePue, what do you do here? Ball's on the Ohio 36-yard line. It's fourth down and 18. Do you punt it and play defense, or do you go for it? He's kept his offense out there, at least right now.
I'd say normal situation, you punt, but when you got Heller at the controls.
Might just throw it up towards the end zone or at least towards the sticks and see what they can get. Heller, plenty of time. Penalty flag down. Heller rolling again, looking, and he will put it up, and it is intercepted. Ball is going to be intercepted. No, it's incomplete.
He's out of bounds.
Thought he might have held on to it before he went out of bounds, but he did not. That was Brian Palmer.
77. That penalty is refused. First down.
So it's a holding penalty on Team West Virginia. So Ohio will refuse the penalty, but they will take the ball over now on their 36-yard line. So the Ohio defense able to strengthen right there as we got close to the end. All right, let's go back down to the sideline once again, and our man Dalton Hawes with more with our sponsors. Dalton?
Valley have been reminding adults to prevent, not provide, and now the focus is moving towards Family Talk program. Joining me is Bruno Polina from Muxie Distributing Company. Bruno, tell me more about this proactive program.
We're proud to be a sponsor with the OVAC again this year to remind parents they're the number one influence when it comes to their kids making decisions. It's never too early or too late to start the conversation with their kids about drinking. If they want to learn more, they can go to the AB Family Talk Facebook page. We're happy to be here and wish all the kids best of luck.
All right, thank you, Bruno, and thank you for being a part of the OVAC. Now back to the action.
All right, Dalton, thank you so much. 1:22 to go here in our opening quarter. Ohio picked up 3 yards on first down, so it's 2nd and 7 from their own 29. Ryan Gorman's in at quarterback on this second drive, and that ball is tipped and knocked incomplete that time for Team West Virginia. That was Demetrius DeShields out of University getting his hands on the ball. But Gorman starts this series, the Steuben Mills Central quarterback, and he gets an opportunity under center for Ohio now.
We talked about the size differential, but right there in the middle with Demetrius DeShield and DeAndre Crudup, West Virginia has nice size. Of course, both of them Morgantown natives, one for University, that's DeShield.
That was one of the things that really changed this game a little bit in the years, was when Morgantown, University, and Parkersburg South came into the OVAC and added some real depth for Team West Virginia.
100%.
And they're going to hand the ball off inside, and not much happening there for Team Ohio. A few yards on the carry. It'll take the ball out to about the, 42-yard line, but it's going to be fourth down.
Yeah, there was discussion at one time about making this a North-South All-Star game, which I never would have been in favor of, Scott. And the addition of the Morgantown schools along with South has really helped the West Virginia cause.
Oh,
but
yeah,
on the other side of the coin, you got New Philly and Dover now a factor for Ohio.
Absolutely. So. Yeah, we have, for the first time ever, players from New Philly in the game here tonight.
And they're sending down some quality athletes.
Patterson's back deep to receive the punt from Chevalier once again. See if he has any running room this time. He'll take it at his own 18-yard line, trying to get to the sideline. Can he get there? Yes, he does. And look out. Gage Patterson has excellent speed. He's at midfield, makes a cut, still on his feet, and down to the Ohio 36-yard line. He takes it back to the other line of scrimmage as he returns it all the way back to the 36-yard line.
And that's a scenario the Golden Bear fans are certainly familiar with. He's done this time in and time out for Oakland, and shows his wares there in the All-Star game.
Once he got to the corner here, as you see on our Belmont College replay, great blocks there. And once he got to the edge, he knew he was going to have room to run. And, boy, credit Chevalier there. He made maybe the touchdown-saving tackle right there for Team Ohio.
I believe Chevalier played both ways, so he's not just a kicker.
Yeah, he made the play for Ohio, and West Virginia will take over on the Ohio 36-yard line. First and 10, trips to the near side. We have 20 seconds remaining here in the opening quarter of play. Heller takes the snap. Going deep downfield on the far side, and it is caught, no, dropped. Namak nearly made a phenomenal catch. What an effort that time. Namak was double covered and somehow still got up in between the defenders. And watch it here on the Belmont College replay. He nearly pulls it off.
Well, Carson is a sure-handed receiver. Did a nice job of getting in the air and just about pulled it down, as you said, under double coverage.
He was turning, and he might have scored there had he caught that football. All right, we're back to live action. Still 13 seconds to go here in the opening quarter. Again, trips to the near side. And we've got a flag on the play.
Flag on the field.
Dead ball, false start, offense, number 73, 5-yard penalty, second down.
Now we've seen West Virginia now add up a few penalties here, and not what they want, that's for sure. And this will push the ball back to the 41-yard line, second and 15 from the 41, 13 seconds remaining here in our opening quarter of the 75th annual Rudy Mumley OVAC All-Star football game. Heller again. Pressured up the middle. He's going to come back to the near side and just throws it over the head of his intended receiver, Kobe Hill. But again, we have another flag on the play. Maybe a defensive holding? No, illegal man downfield, it looks like there.
Must have been somebody covered up. I really didn't see a lineman down there.
No. Nope. See what Sam Jones has to say.
But
that looked like the initial call, right?
That is the initial call, yes.
still have 6.6 seconds remaining here. Incomplete pass, and with the penalty, clock stop. Chicken's talking it over with the Ohio captains, see what they want to do. Will Balgo looking to the sideline for some answers.
That's been a big change over the last
An eligible couple. Receiver. Downfield on the offense. Number 16 was covered up.
Yeah, I knew it had to be
that penalty is refused. Third down.
Third down. All right. So, just like you suspected, Tom.
Yeah, I didn't see any linemen in the area, so usually that's a case of someone being covered up. Of course, with all the different formations they're throwing out there, it's going to happen on occasion.
All right, so third and 15 now. We still have 6 seconds. We played 20 seconds here, and it's taken us about 4 minutes at least. They're going to toss it out to Stevie Mitchell. Mitchell, with some running room, lowers his head. He'll pick up about 6 yards on the play, but that'll take us to the end of the quarter. It'll be fourth and 10 for Team West Virginia when we come back for the second quarter of action. But we've got more on the sidelines now as well. We're going to go back down to the sidelines and our Dalton Hawes with another one of our sponsors. Dalton.
Fans down on the sidelines, joining me is Kelly Baker, the Huntington Bank St. Clairsville branch manager. Huntington Bank has been a corporate partner of the OVAC for over 15 years now, and one of their signature assets is being the presenting sponsor for this big game. Also, Huntington Bank and the OVAC will be sponsoring the Community Service Scholarship this year. Kelly, tell me more about this scholarship.
So, with the scholarship and this amazing event, we know is named after Rudy Mumley and all of his service that he did, his legacy is still with us today. So Huntington created this scholarship to give back to students who are doing service outside of school and impacting their communities positively.
Sounds great. Kelly, we appreciate your support from Huntington Bank. And fans, enjoy the rest of the game.
All right, Dalton, thank you so much. And the 2021 Rudy Mumley OVAC All-Star Charity Football Game is being presented by Huntington Bank and is being brought to you in part by Belmont College. HMS PPS, CA House Music, Youth System Service, and Bordas and Bordas. And our OVAC Student Athlete Achievement Award, which is powered by Belmont College, I want to tell you about that, is an award to the best all-around combined boys and girls programs in athletic competition and academics, also from the classroom. Now, points are earned and tracked throughout the year based on final standings and placement in championship events across all sports in combination with overall grade point averages. One winning school from each of the five OVAC classes will be crowned at the end of the school year and recognized during the annual Banquet of Champions in May. All right, we're back to action here as we get started for the second quarter. And, Tom, they're going to go for it here on 4th and 9. Here's Heller, some pressure, rolling to the near side, and he's going to find his receiver, and it's going to be knocked incomplete. Intended for Kobe Hill. He had his hands on it, but he just couldn't pull it in. Jake Rose from River did a great job to break that pass up.
And that pass really didn't have a chance.
And no chance there for Team West Virginia, but hey, they went for it on 4th down again. Why not when you're that deep into your opponent's territory, right?
Yeah, and Heller has shown the ability is it on that 3rd and 23 where they converted. So Tonkovich is back in as the quarterback for Ohio.
So Tyler Tonkovich, St. Clairsville's quarterback, great athlete, great pitcher as well, helped lead that team to a baseball regional. Just an excellent athlete and did a great job leading Brett McLean's charges these last couple of years. He'll hand it off inside, and that's going to be Evan Carpenter from Martins Ferry.
I'll tell you, of all the athletes I saw in their media day, Carpenter was one of the most impressive. I'll tell you, he is a stud.
Evan Carpenter is a player. There's no doubt about that, and it doesn't matter what side of the football you're talking about with Evan Carpenter. He finds a way to get it done, that's for sure.
Yeah, 2-time Eastern District Player of the Year. So, and interesting enough, he's playing on the offensive side of the ball tonight.
Yeah, right.
Shows the caliber of athletes that Ohio has on both sides of the football.
Yeah, ran for 769 yards last year for Martins Ferry and had 14 touchdowns, but a fumble on the play here, and it's recovered by West Virginia. And Kyler O'Connor is going to score. The Oakland Golden Bear picks it up and runs it into the end zone for the touchdown. Our first touchdown of the game is a fumble recovery for a score by Kyler O'Connor from Oak Glen.
Talking to Coach DePure in the week, he said, if you call Kyler O'Connor's name several times during this broadcast, he said it's going to bode well for West Virginia. And right there, he comes up with a big-time play.
Yeah, the WVU Medicine replay shows O'Connor just, boy, picking up the nice bounce and takes it right in. That was almost like a made-to-order, like, you know, 6-4-3 double play, the way they think that just bounced right up into his hands, and he was able to take it into the end zone for the first touchdown of the game. Joe Lima on to kick now.
Couldn't have received a better bounce.
You'll notice, too, at Wheeling Island Stadium, I noticed this tonight when I first got here, look, no trees in the background anymore in the north end zone.
And they have been there forever.
Forever.
Trust me.
I was shocked when I came here, and I'm like, what's different? And then I noticed the trees are gone and brand new fencing there as well. So kind of a neat look. It really opens things up here at Wheeling Island. Again, on the WVU Medicine replay, tough with the pitch there from Tonkovich to Carpenter. Little hard for him to handle. And you could see that West Virginia quickly took advantage of it.
When talking to James Wallace throughout the week, he said we need to create some turnovers, and there's a huge one right there.
Absolutely. Not only just a turnover, but a turnover into points. And that's exactly what West Virginia was able to do with the play right there. So Ohio kind of getting in their own way here lately, but right now they have been able to find a way to try to get things done once again. And the 17th annual OVAC Hall of Fame annual induction will be held at West Banco Arena. And that's coming up. They had to postpone it last year, but it's coming up on Saturday, August the 14th at West Banco Arena. So you will have the classes of 2020 and also the classes of 2021 that will be honored at the OVAC's 17th annual Hall of Fame induction ceremony. Again, Saturday, August the 14th at West Banco Arena.
Scott, I say this all the time. Any Ohio Valley fan that has 2 or 3 hours in any afternoon or any evening, take a trip down to the Civic Center. It is a museum-quality shrine to the OVAC. You can spend hours there. I know some rainy days we get in there just for the heck of it, and it's just unbelievable. It's the history of the OVAC, and it is professional quality. Hats off to all the people involved with that, Doug Huff and Tom Radizak and company, and just an unbelievable shrine to the OVAC.
And the thing that's great is, you know, all the high schools that are still represented, all the high schools that were in the OVAC, if they have material that they've provided, it is on display at the OVAC Hall of Fame at West Banco Arena. Here's Lima with the kick, and Ohio looking to return it. And that's Moore coming up over the 15, got some room, makes a move at the 25. Nice job by Dylan Moore to bring it all the way out to about the 27-yard line for Ohio. He's been the most impactful player for Team Ohio, I would say, so far in this game, Tom.
Yeah, and he doesn't leave the field too often, but absolutely.
You see it on the WVU Medicine replay.
I'm not sure he hasn't played every snap so far, Scott.
Yeah, the kid just goes, and a couple of really nice moves here by him to stay on his feet and finally brought down with the tackle there at about the 27-yard line. See who Ohio comes out with at quarterback this time. Looks like it'll stay with Tonkovich. It will still be Tyler Tonkovich from St. Clairsville. Carpenter is still in the backfield with him. Moore is out wide to the near side, and they have double wings on this play as well. Tonkovich looks to throw and tried to find one of his wing backs. That was intended for Jeremy Brown out of Indian Creek, but the ball was thrown a little low at his feet and incomplete.
Yeah, and so far Ohio hasn't established that running game that they'd like to do.
And West Virginia's done a good job up front. You talk about that defensive front for West Virginia with guys like Bruick that's in there, and we talked about the players from University and Morgantown as well, Crudup that's in there for them. They are doing a good job, really, to help control that line of scrimmage.
Yeah, I think Spencer Helms from Winning Central.
I think
now,
he is 73 now, is down in
the,
there.
Yeah, he's been on the offense throughout the game, but now he's on the defensive side.
Yes, sir. And Cody Poe from 100 is also out there right now.
Great
story. Defensive
end,
and we'll have more on his story coming up here in just a few moments. Great kid, and you're going to really – I think it's inspiring what he's looking to do with his life and his career. Here's the inside handoff there, and not much happening from Matt Schaefer that time from Indian Creek as he picks up a short gain of about 2 or 3 yards, and it's going to be third down and 8 now from Ohio from just around their 29-yard line.
Yeah, and Crudup and DeShields were given a brief blow there for just a couple downs, but they're back in there on a third down situation.
Yeah, you see DeShield, number 55, in that bright, shiny helmet. Looks like a Golden Domer. Bear, you probably like that helmet for sure.
Love
a University helmet, the University Hawks. Marco Apri from Lindsley is inside of him at a tackle right now, and Kyler O'Connor also, along with Crudup, here on third down. Tonkovich is going to roll, And he's being pressured. That is O'Connor pressuring him, and he throws the ball, and it is incomplete. Intended for his receiver that time, Matt Schaefer out of Indian Creek. But again, Tonkovic being pressured heavily by O'Connor. And you see Kyler O'Connor making a direct impact in this game for sure for West Virginia.
Yeah, it appeared that Tonkovic had some running room, but Kyler O'Connor closed that play down rather rapidly. A little undersized, 185 pounds, that defensive end, but certainly making his presence felt.
Well, Chevalier will be back into punt now for West Virginia, the Warren local graduate. And Stevie Mitchell from Wheeling Park is now back to receive the punt, standing at about his own 35-yard line. Here's the punt, high floating kick, and Mitchell will call for a fair catch at the 36, and that's where he will make it. Chevalier's done a nice job with the punting, to say the least. A lot of good hang time.
Yeah, he averaged about 40 yards a punt this season, so certainly a quality kicker.
Now let's go back down to the sideline once again to our Dalton Hawes. This time, he's standing by with West Liberty University's Ron Witt. Dalton?
Hi, fans. I'm Dalton Hawes. Joining me on the sidelines is the West Liberty University Alumni Affairs Executive Director, Mr. Ron Witt. Ron, it always seems like there's exciting new news coming out of West Liberty all the time. Tell me more about the total college experience that the university provides.
Absolutely. Thanks, Dalton. Well, we're always doing everything for the betterment of our students. That means new academic programs. We have more master's programs that we're offering for our students to give them that wonderful academic experience. Plus, we have new facilities. And to make them have a great social experience as well. It's been such a challenging year, and we're anxious to get our students back on campus to experience everything that West Liberty has to offer. And we're just excited to be here.
Oh, you saw right there, boy, turnover, and that's what we talked about, turnovers in this game. And the interception by Carter Dennis of River after the ball was tipped at the line of scrimmage from Bo Heller. And now Ohio in great position on the West Virginia 40-yard line.
Yeah, West Virginia's been all West Virginia, but now Ohio with their chance.
And Gorman's going to go to the air, and guess who makes the catch? Dylan Moore. Down at about the 24-yard line, and a nice gain for Ohio of 16 yards on first down. It's Ryan Gorman, the quarterback out of Steubenville Catholic Central, able to hook up with Dylan Moore out of Beaver Local.
Tackle on the play by Peyton Marley.
And so Ohio now in great field position, first down on the West Virginia 24-yard line.
Of course, Ryan Gorman, he's one of the father-son combinations. His dad, Ted, who is the principal at Steubenville High School, played several years ago.
Gorman will give an inside handoff this time to Garrett Dozier. Dozier stays on his feet and works all the way down to about the 16-yard line. So a gain of about 9 yards on first down. You saw that inside wing tee handoff there that worked well as he cuts it inside the guard and is able to pick up nice yardage. And Dozier, a player who had an outstanding career at Toronto.
Yeah, Coach Kevin Welsh, a 41-year veteran, is calling the plays for high end. Hope we can get into his story. He has appeared at seven OVA schools throughout his career. He played in a 1973 game.
Here's Gorman. A handoff right this time inside to Evan Carpenter. And Carpenter will bounce his way for a first down over the 15-yard line and down to about the 13. So it'll be first and 10 for Ohio at the West Virginia 13-yard line with 9 minutes remaining here in our second quarter.
Scott, if you only need 2 or 3 yards, Evan Carpenter is certainly the guy you want with the football.
He is the man to do it. There's no doubt about that. So Gorman continuing in at quarterback here on this drive. Carpenter in at the tailback. Matthew Schaefer and Dozier are the wingbacks. Here's Carpenter. Carpenter right up the gut. Powers his way down over the 5 to about the 4-yard line. It'll be second down and less than 1 for Ohio as they're inside the 5-yard line.
Yeah, some slick ball handling there by Ryan Gorman. But
for one play.
You don't have to be fancy. All you got to do is get the ball to the big guy.
They give it to Carpenter, and he goes down to the 4-yard line for Ohio. Carpenter again at the tail position. One wide out to the far side, double wingbacks, motion, and the give is to Schaefer, and he will get into the end zone for the Ohio touchdown. Indian Creek's Matt Schaefer goes 4 yards and scores. And West Virginia has given up their first touchdown of the night as Ohio gets on the board for the first time in this game. It's now 10-6.
Of course, we always say in All-Star games, mistakes and turnovers are going to be the big factors.
Yep.
And right there, Ohio takes advantage of the turnover.
They did the same thing that West Virginia was able to do on the turnover they were able to get. They scored. West Virginia scored immediately. Ohio turns the turnover into points as Schaefer pounds his way in from 4 yards. Now, will they go for two or will they kick? It looks like they might go for two. I see Aiden Hannis out there, of course, outstanding athlete from Barnesville, and he's going to line up at quarterback here. So it looks like Ohio will go for two. That's Brian Palmer from Buckeye Local in motion. They snap it and give it to one of the up men, and nothing doing there. West Virginia was planning on it and looking for it for sure as they try to get Schaefer into the end zone again.
Scott, it was unsuccessful, but I really like it because, like I said, you wouldn't expect that from Fort Fry, a very conservative wing T type team, and Coach Eric Huck pulling out all stops here. So really like his attitude, and looks like we're going to have an interesting
fans,
football
I'm
game
Dalton
here
Haas
tonight.
Joining me on the sidelines is Eric
so
Pethel,
far,
the
that
director.
That is for sure, and we hope that the excitement here will continue at Wheeling Island Stadium with 8:14 remaining in the first half. West Virginia still leads on our Huntington Bank scoreboard by a count of 10-6. Let's go back down to the sideline once again as our Dalton Haas is with another one of our outstanding sponsors. Dalton?
I just do what I'm told.
Right on, buddy.
On the sidelines, I'm Dalton Haas. Joining me is Eric Petho, the director of the Health Management Solutions and Paramount Preferred Solutions, which is the exclusive workers' compensation managed care organization and third-party administrator of the OVAC. Eric, how has this partnership helped service our schools in the Ohio Valley as well as businesses?
Paramount Insurance, very proud to give back to the communities we serve. And when you think about supporting the Ohio Valley, giving back to the Ohio Valley, supporting the Ohio Valley Athletic Conference is just a super way. Very proud to have an opportunity to support
right,
the
thank you,
schools,
and
their
you
students,
saw there on the kick.
Their student athletes.
Much
and,
happening for Sincere Sinclair and
we
Team West Virginia.
We appreciate your continued support,
as
Eric.
He is
thank
taken
you.
Down at about the 17-yard line. So West Virginia takes over first and 10 on their own 17-yard line. And, of course, our man Eric Petho that was being interviewed right there, pretty good athlete in his own right, to say the least. And his sister wasn't a bad basketball player either.
She scored a few points for the University of Pittsburgh.
So it'll be first and 10 now for West Virginia as it's now a 10-6 West Virginia lead. 8:09 remaining in the second quarter. Heller still at quarterback. And he'll take the snap and looks to throw it. And it is going to be pulled in and caught by Kobe Hill. And Hill gets all the way up to the 35-yard line. And boy, I can't tell you how many times I watched Bo Heller throw that pass last year for Wheeling Park right here on this field.
I'll tell you, right on the money. And Kobe Hill did a nice job of securing possession.
Way to pick up a quick, almost 20 yards right there for West Virginia. Bad snap. Heller just has to fall on it again, and he'll lose yardage all the way back to about the 26-yard line is where they will officially mark him down. And that's going to be a loss of 10 yards on the play, Tom. So it's now second down and 20 from the 26. A couple of bad snaps have really hurt West Virginia drives now.
Yeah, the only thing is with Bo Heller, you know, there's the potential for that big play, so.
Yeah, no doubt about it. He can turn a broken play into a big play. Heller to the air again, has his man, passes pulled in, and he'll get the lost yardage back on the far side as it's pulled in that time for West Virginia.
Jeremy Brown.
And that was Peyton Marling from Wheeling Central making the catch on the far sideline. And Marling, of course, had an outstanding career at Wheeling Central. He was a key player for Coach Mike Young's team during his time there. Here's Heller again trying to set up the middle screen. Does to Stevie Mitchell. There's running room for Mitchell, and Mitchell will get it up to about the 45-yard line. Still going to be about a yard and a half to 2 yards shy of the first down. And it's going to be fourth down and about two from near midfield. And I think this time they may decide to punt it. But, yes, I see Heller finally going off the field now.
Yeah, Coach DePue is sent on the kicking team. And a wise decision here.
Yeah, you're at your own 45 here. Mitchell nearly broke it, was almost able to get the first down, but unable to just do so. And so they will now have to punt the ball back over to Team Ohio. And Dylan Moore is the man back deep to receive it. As the punt is off the foot of Jordan Waterhouse. Wobbly kick that'll land at the 20, but gets a good roll on a great punt. Can they get it before it goes in the end zone? Yes! Ball is down at the 1 yard line. And it looks like that was Carter, excuse me, not Carter, I'm on the wrong side. Jason Beisel, number 22 of Magnolia, as we look at it again on the WVU Medicine replay. that was the man that finally was able to get down on top of it. See, Alex Burton was there from West Virginia. And, boy, I don't know if his foot touched the goal line or not.
It's the ball, Scott.
Doesn't matter. Okay.
Doesn't matter. But Jason Basel, 5'4", 135. He's all football player, trust me.
And how about,
knows.
How about this field position for Ohio with 6:09 remaining here in the second quarter, and they are backed up to their own goal line.
I believe that was about a 54-yard punt, Scott.
Yes. And here we go on first down, just trying to get out of the end zone is Schaefer, and he's going to do that and more. Matt Schaefer with a big run for Ohio all the way out to the 32-yard line. We'll mark him down at the 31, a gain of 30 yards on first down. What a great play, just what you needed when you're standing in the shadows of your own goalpost. Matt Schaefer on the WV Medicine replay picks up a big play for Team Ohio. Hey, folks, we want to remind you that you can follow the OVAC on Facebook. That's right. Also on Twitter, Instagram, and everywhere. They're all over social media. You can find pictures, articles, and updates of everything OVAC on the OVAC Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram account. So get on there and follow the OVAC today. All right, with 5:59 remaining here before the halftime, West Virginia leads 10-6 in the 75th annual Rudy Mumley OVAC All-Star Game. We'll take a break. Back with more second quarter action after this.
The 2019 band director, presented by Van and Amanda.
We're doing exciting things at the WU Heart and Vascular Institute in advanced heart failure, in valvular heart disease, in atrial fibrillation, and even heart transplantation. We know that if patients can achieve advanced care in their home community, they do better. We provide the entire spectrum of care, and our outcomes are amongst the best in the nation.
Visit mywvuheart.com.
When an emergency threatens, turn to the most experienced specialist in the area. With certified experts in every department, we're the local name to trust. Rely on our state-of-the-art diagnostic tools and years of experience. No crisis is too big or too small. We will help you perform your best. Put your problems in the hands of the experts. Choose CA House Music and play music for life.
Hey, you. Yeah, you. Have you registered for classes this fall at West Liberty University? Why not? You still have time. West Liberty University offers more than 70 majors with more than 30 undergraduate and graduate academic programs that are recognized nationally or have national accreditation. Plus, we award more than $6 million in scholarships annually. What are you waiting for? Classes begin August 23rd. Visit westliberty.edu/apply to get started.
And we are back at Wheeling Island Stadium, and a special thanks to the media partners of the 2021 Rudy Mumley OVAC All-Star Charity Football Classic, AM 1600 WKKX and AM 1370 WVOY, Lamar Advertising, the Times Leader, and the Intelligencer and News Register, all proud media partners for the 2021 Rudy Mumley OVAC All-Star Football Charity Classic.
That last play, the inside handoff went to Garrett Dozier, the running back from Toronto.
He ran for 3,325 yards in his career at Toronto with 30 touchdowns. He's also the school record holder in career wrestling wins with 172, Tom. Pretty good athlete, to say the least. Gorman going up top, and it is out of bounds. Intended, though, that time for Dylan Moore, his intended receiver, and pretty good coverage there by Gage Ryder. And you talk about a history with the game. Gage Ryder and his family.
It would take us to halftime to cover everything, but his grandfather, Dave, of course, a longtime coach in Brook County, played in back in the 60s. Carl Foder was a relative, a pretty outstanding quarterback, played a little football up in Canada throughout his career, and not to mention his brothers who just played and cousin who just played recently. So
he's the sixth player in his family in family history to play in this game. Pretty impressive, that's for sure.
Absolutely.
Inside handoff goes to Carpenter, and nothing doing that time. West Virginia all over the play. And, yeah, good defensive effort in front. Prudup, I see him in on the tackle that time. For Team Ohio, West Virginia, I think Steve Felton was also in on the tackle, number 8 from Lindsley. And we're going to have a timeout on the field here. Well, number 56 was sent off for Team West Virginia. Sam Jones announced here. Not exactly sure why, but
I think it might have been an equipment issue.
Might have been an equipment issue, maybe something with his helmet. So Ohio will punt. Chevaliers back in to punt. And West Virginia will receive the kick. Chevaliers done a nice job. Another good booming punt off of his foot. Patterson just lets it bounce. And Ohio will let it roll a little bit now. Now Patterson comes up near it. And Will Balgo finally will just put his hand on it and mark it dead at the 30-yard line. So we have 4:22 remaining here in the second quarter. West Virginia leads 10-6 on our Huntington Bank scoreboard over Ohio. I want to let you know, coming up at halftime, we will have the presentation of our Queen of Queens and also the McDonald's All-Star Band performance that's coming up at halftime. So make sure you stay with us for all of that exciting action. See what West Virginia can do here, though, with the final 4:22. Both teams still have all three of their timeouts. Here's Heller now, once again, in the gun for West Virginia. Waterhouse is behind him. Three wide receivers to the near side, and I think we have motion, Bear.
Yes, Stevie Mitchell, I think, moved just a little bit there.
Dead ball, ball start, offense, number 10. Excuse me, correction, number 25.
Yep. So yeah, you were right with Stevie Mitchell.
Park had all three of their receivers. Bo had all three of his, and he, once again, three Park receivers out to the right side.
Here's Heller. He'll ride it into Waterhouse, then send it outside to Mitchell. Mitchell with some running room. Got kind of tight down the sideline, but he'll get it up to about the 33-yard line. So a gain of eight nearly there on the, well, gain of eight on the play after the lost yardage on the penalty. So it's still going to bring up second down and seven.
Of course, not a whole lot of room on this side. They're operating from the right hash, but Stevie Mitchell has the potential to go all the way on every play.
He finds a way to make it work, and he can tight line, tight rope with the best of them. Here's Heller again to the air. A little pressure, going to go downfield, and has a receiver, and it is pulled in. Carson Namak, his Wheeling Park teammate, makes the catch at the Ohio 41-yard line.
I'll tell you, he might not have the greatest speed on the field, but Carson Namak can catch the football.
A sure-handed receiver, to say the least. Watch it again here on the WV Medicine replay. Goes up, meets the ball at its high point, and makes the reception. So first and 10, West Virginia. They still have 4 minutes to go. Can they get something done before halftime? Heller with a man in motion, and he'll give it to Waterhouse, and nothing happening for Waterhouse that time, as Ohio is right there to meet him in the backfield.
The amazing factor in the first half is West Virginia really hasn't run the ball successfully.
No.
But they've been able to keep Bo Heller on his feet and completing passes. So that bodes well for the Mountaineers.
Only a loss of a yard that time. So it's second and 11. Clock turns. We're down to 3 minutes and 30 seconds. There's a bouncing ball on the turf, and able to get on it for West Virginia was Waterhouse. Heller had fallen, was reaching for the ball, but Waterhouse saves the day by recovering it back on their own 48-yard line. So a huge loss of yardage there for the Mountaineers. It's going to set up a third and extremely long now. Third and 21 for West Virginia from their own 48-yard line.
I think that's something West Virginia will look to clean up at halftime. The snaps to the quarterback, been three costly ones.
So it's third and 21 from the 48. Heller to the air, pressured and sacked. Reese Skaggs is the man from St. Clairsville who comes in and makes the tackle, and he's one of those father-son duos that we've talked about already in this game. His father, Walt, playing in this game back in the 80s.
Yeah, Walt played back in 87. Of course, long-time administrator in the St. Clairsville School District.
On the WVU Medicine replay, you see Skaggs making the play once again, and he's headed off to play college football, going to go to Concord University to continue his football playing career. So we've got a timeout that has been taken here on the field with 2:49 remaining in the opening half. Ohio taking the timeout. And so obviously the Buckeyes hoping to try to do something with the football, Tom, before we go to the half.
Yeah, they'd like to get it back and make something happen here. West Virginia, on the other hand, got a long way to go for that first down.
West Virginia, when you think about their defense has really done a good job. The only points they've allowed was following the turnover that was deep inside their end. They've forced Ohio, really, to have long fields and not much success so far.
Well, let's be honest. I'd like to see the play ratio here. West Virginia has controlled the football throughout. And you keep the ball out of their hands, that bodes well for your defense.
Yeah, we can see time of possession right now. I'm sure it's been heavily on the side probably of West Virginia, even though Ohio is is a run-oriented team, and West Virginia is a pass-first team.
So, indeed, it is fourth down, so we're going to have
We've got a penalty that's been tossed here.
Dead ball. 12 men on the field. Substitution on the defense. 12 players on the game prior to the snap.
Not going to have that in an all-star game.
Yeah, not going to cost
penalty.
Not going to cost them real big.
Luckily,
here.
It wasn't fourth and four. So now they'll move the ball up to the 42-yard line. This is Waterhouse to punt again. Had an excellent punt the last time. It was down all the way at the 1 yard line. Moore is back to receive for Ohio, and I believe that's Brian Palmer too from Buckeye Local. This time, just a high end-over-end wobbly kick that Moore takes at the 25-yard line. Good coverage by West Virginia, but Moore gets outside, and he's got a lot of room. Moore finally taken down by Flowers and Waterhouse at about the 45-yard line, but an excellent return once again from Dylan Moore.
I'll tell you, this little fella is exciting, fun to watch. And
5'8", 160 pounds, but he makes plays all over the field, whether it's defense, offense, special teams. And you see him here again on the WVU Medicine replay, breaking tackles and able to get to the corner. And a good seal block there as well on the corner for Ohio by Jeremy Brown from Indian Creek.
Credit Jordan Waterhouse, the kicker who made the touchdown-saving tackle.
Well, Ohio's got 2:35 remaining and a pair of timeouts to see if they can get some points before halftime here on their own 42-yard line. Ohio running another player off and another player on here.
No, we got some confusion
here. And we're going to have a timeout that has to be taken. So Ohio takes the timeout. That'll be their second now, Tom.
Yeah, the 11th player ran off, and they had to put 11th player back on. So
Ohio working things over. Obviously, again, all-star games, you're going to have a little bit of confusion. There's no doubt about that. Really, for the most part, I think both teams have done pretty well in terms of, you know, getting teams and things organized. You only have a week, and it's not even really a full week.
They always say a week. It's really 4.5 days.
Right.
And, you know, credit to these coaches. You know, it takes a day or two just to get to know the players' names, you know.
Sure.
But I was really impressed in talking to both coaching staffs. They did work in selecting these teams. It wasn't just haphazard. They sat down, they watched huddle, they watched game films, and really made an effort to construct their teams. And Fort Frye in particular, they wanted that wing T-type team. They went for the big lineman, and the coaches said they spent virtually throughout the winter season studying huddle films and trying to pick the best players.
And there are 37 players on each roster this year, Tom, as opposed to the normal 33. They went a little deeper, obviously, with concerns over COVID and things like that. Here's the handoff, and trying to get to the outside is Schaefer again. West Virginia had him bottled up, but Schaefer breaks tackles, and finally O'Connor is the man who comes in and takes him down. Dalton Flowers was also in on the tackle for West Virginia, but it was O'Connor that finished it off.
Yeah, Coach Hawk told me earlier in the week, keep an eye on Matt Schaefer. He and Carpenter are two tough customers, and right there, that's a pretty strong running back.
Yeah, Carpenter and Schaefer, is a man who can find the way to move the football.
I think West Virginia might have an extra player out there on the field somewhere, Scott. There's a lot of blue jerseys.
See, we have here from Mr. Sam Jones.
Indeed, there's 12.
Dead ball, illegal participation on the defense. 12 players on the field prior to the snap. That's a 5-yard penalty. Replay second down. Correction, the yardage results in a first down.
Yeah, I thought we were going to get a first down there. Yeah. And talking about Schaefer, he's a kid who just last season for Creek ran for just over 700 yards and had 10 touchdowns for the Redskins. So in what was a pretty well-developed offense, and one that they shared the ball a lot, but he still found his time to get the ball and did well when he had it. Here's Tonkovich to the air, and his pass is going to be pulled in and caught. That's Garrett Dozier. And Dozier makes the catch down at the 41-yard line, gets out of bounds. Oh, they'll wind the clock. He was tackled inbounds, so they will wind the clock.
On the coverage for West Virginia.
So Ohio now going with three wides, no tailback, and a couple of wingbacks. And here's Tonkovich. He can run with the ball. He's going to throw it, though, over the middle, and it is incomplete. Looked like Moore might have had it.
Yeah, nice job by the umpire coming in.
The umpire, though, watched it the entire way and called it incomplete from the get-go.
Yeah,
watch it again here on the WVU Medicine replay.
I'll tell you, Tonkovich was real close to being over the line of scrimmage.
And you can see that when that ball came in there, it looked like it hit the turf before he's able to get both hands underneath of it.
Certainly appeared the ground aided the catch.
Third down and five.
So it's going to be third and five now for Ohio. And Tonkovich again in the gun. Look out. He's hit as he throws, and it is incomplete. Gage Patterson coming on the blitz that time, laid out Tonkovich just as he was releasing the football. So it's going to be 4th and 5. Clock stops on the incomplete pass with 1:29 remaining.
Fourth down.
Boy, Patterson showed his speed on that play, just how he came off the edge. And he plays safety on this, so a safety blitz from this West Virginia defense that was dialed up and at the right time, because we'll see what Ohio elects to do here on 4th and 5. Looks like
Chevalier, the kicker, is on the field.
He's in, but, yeah, okay, he is dropping back because Ohio does bring the punter out. West Virginia had already dropped Patterson back to receive.
Yeah, kind of ready to huddle up on a kicking play.
And that's what, and they're going to fake it. And here you go, Carpenter. Oh, boy, this is going to be so close, Tom.
Yeah.
He needed the 36.
I'm going to say
the
he's near about...
The Judge is marking the 36, but if you look at the sticks, it's just over the 36,
I'm
going to
say
it?
He's 3 inches short.
I think he's just short of it, too.
We're going to need a measurement.
We are going to need a measurement here. Boy, this is huge because with 1:25 remaining... A minute 25 remaining in the opening half. It's either going to be West Virginia ball at their own 36 or Ohio ball at the 36, still with a timeout, trailing 10-6 here at Wheeling Island Stadium. So they're going to have to bring the chain crew across from the far side. And as we were looking at it, it looked like the stick, the lead stick, was just further past the 36-yard line than where he got to. Let's see what happens here as they'll mark it off. And it's going to be short, Tom. Like you said, Tom.
It's an indication there by referee Chicken Jones.
Yep. Just short, but you kind of thought maybe something was up, right, because they huddled.
Like I said, when they huddled, that's rather unusual that you'd huddle on a kicking play.
Yes, and that's what threw me off for a minute, where I thought maybe they're going to go for it.
And indeed they did.
And they did, but not with the offense, but with the punt team. But, hey, again, all-star game, why not pull that out?
Yeah, I like
it. What do you lose? It's on the 36-yard line anyways. It's deep in their territory. So,
yeah.
And they nearly pulled it off.
Yeah, I like Coach Huck's style. He's a little bit of riverboat gambler.
Yeah, you're here to have fun and here to win, that's for sure. And West Virginia, though, bears still with all three of their timeouts. So can Bo Heller and company get something done and possibly put more points on the scoreboard?
I'm sure they're going
to
try.
Here's Heller. Again in the gun, trips to the far side. Mitchell's in the backfield with him. And they'll throw it on the slant, and it's pulled in and caught by Patterson, who stays on his feet. Look out. Patterson is able to get up to about the 48-yard line. It's a gain of about 13, giving 14 yards, and it'll be a first down for West Virginia. And again, you see that speed from Patterson and the elusiveness that he has, that even when you think you have him tackled, you don't. Back to live action here. Hear it again with Patterson making the catch. And again, a gain of about 8-9 yards on first down. And you see West Virginia going back to that quick pass action that they had so much success with earlier. Tom, they don't throw a bunch of deep passes, a lot of them worth 5 yards of the line of scrimmage.
Bo Heller has put the ball on the numbers.
Yes, he has. Here's Heller again. It's 2nd and short. Now he's looking downfield. Penalty flag, and he's just going to throw it out of bounds. And that'll stop the clock. We have a flag on the play. And we'll see what our referee, Sam Jones, has.
And, of course, Chicken Jones is going to get him for grounding, which is a good call.
There's two penalties on the play then.
Yeah, we're going to have a hold. We're going to have a hold in the ground, I believe.
There are two fouls on the play. Holding offense, number 60. That penalty is refused. We have intentional grounding on the offense, number 7. That's a 5-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. It's also a loss of down. And the clock will start on a ready-for-play signal.
Now, there you go. Sam doing a great job to tell the folks exactly what's happening with the rule here. Excellent job.
Of course, Sam's the rules interpreter for board, so he's
he's
well-versed on the rules.
He knows the rules. There's no doubt about that. And he's a guy that works constantly. I saw him at the American Legion Area 1 tournament this week.
Time out.
Umpiring.
Of course, West Virginia.
Chicken's a veteran of 34 years, and I've told him personally, no one has improved over those 34 years as an official other than Chicken Jones. He works it. It's his craft, and God bless him. He's a great individual.
Of course, was longtime athletic director at Buckeye Local High School. Did a great job in that role, too, and always willing to help and to answer questions and just, you know, do whatever he can. He loves being involved with high school athletics and with the kids, and it's great to have those kind of people involved. You need men and women like this. And I know, Tom, you being an umpire and an official, just how important that involvement is from people that want to get involved, whether it's football, basketball, softball, You need people to get involved so that the kids can play.
Yeah, and we can't encourage the youngsters out there. If you have an inkling that you want to umpire, you want to officiate, whether it be basketball, football, wrestling, whatever the case, the OVAC is in dire need of officials. We need that next generation to step up and, believe me, try it. You'll have a lifetime of fun and keeps you young being around these kids.
Pretty good part-time job, too, right, Tom? I mean, you can go out and have fun and you earn a little bit of money.
Yeah, back in my day, you made $2, but nowadays it's a little bit
lucrative. A little better than that. Yeah. All right, so here we are now, West Virginia with the ball, 3rd and 22 from their own 35-yard line following the penalties. Heller rolling, still rolling. He's in trouble here, and he's going to go down. And will Ohio take their final timeout? Oh, we got some pushing and shoving after the fact, and now a penalty flag comes out. Some pushing and shoving after Heller had gone down on the sack. We'll see what Sam Jones has here. Talking it over right now to see officially.
Dead ball, personal foul. Number 70 on the defense. 15-yard penalty from the end of the run. The down will be fourth down. Timeout, Ohio. That's their third and final timeout.
All right, so the penalty was against Ohio for unsportsmanlike conduct. You'll see it here on the replay. And you see some pushing and shoving. Daniel Beals from Oak Glen there, 51 for West Virginia involved in the pushing and shoving. And I think it was, he said 70, but I think it was 78.
Yeah, I believe
Timothy
it was.
Ware from Caldwell. Not a 70 on the Ohio roster.
Yeah.
And that looked like Ware, 6 foot, 275 pounder out of Caldwell. So it's a 15-yard penalty, but it really doesn't hurt Ohio that much. And you're going to have some of that these games.
It was one of those. It really wasn't much, but unfortunately he did it out in the open
right,
where everyone could see it. And he kind of forced the official's hand there.
So we still have 30 seconds remaining. Ohio has taken their last and final timeout before halftime. Still on the board, but they have taken it. Maybe they'll take it off once we get back out of this. West Virginia will be punting the ball from their own 35-yard line. Moore and Palmer are going to be the deep men back to receive here. And let's see who they bring out to punt. Looks like they're going to go with Waterhouse once again. He's taken the last three punts for Team West Virginia.
Why not? That 54-yarder, he boomed.
They need one of those right now. If he can knock that off his foot, that would be a big help for Team West Virginia. Whereas Ohio, they're hoping to get as great a field position as they can to try to see if they can't work towards the end zone before halftime.
They'd like to see the football in Dylan Moore's hands, trust me.
If you're West Virginia, you might try to punt it towards 6, Palmer, but no, he's going to let it bounce. And look out, will West Virginia get on top of it? Yes, they will. Wow, what another outstanding punt from Jordan Waterhouse. Patterson, the man down there, to run it down and down it inside the 5-yard line. And I would have to think that changes everything that Ohio's going to do before halftime now.
Scott, I think 62 yards. Is that possible? Was it from the 35?
It was from the 35-yard line.
And it's down around the 4, so that's 39, about 61.
You got a great bounce and roll. There's no doubt about that. But, boy, yeah. Waterhouse has put on a show with his punch and Chevalier from Ohio. We've seen two excellent punters in this game, that's for sure, that have really helped change field position and change the trajectory of the game.
Yeah, I think if you're high, you just got to kneel on it, go to halftime. And
yeah, you're looking just to get out of here, still only down 10-6. You're only down 4, and, of course, you've got the whole second half still coming up. And the thing, too, that you have to think about in a game like this is you're going to have an extended halftime. This is not your normal, typical halftime for sure, so you know, you're going to have plenty of time to really talk things over, come up with a good plan for second half as Gorman will take the snap and the knee, and that'll run the clock out as we will go to halftime here at Wheeling Island Stadium. And on our Huntington Bank scoreboard, you see it's West Virginia leading Ohio 10-6 as we go to halftime here at Wheeling Island Stadium. Really an entertaining and fun game so far, to say the least, between these two teams. And great weather, beautiful night. What more can you ask for,
Tom? Yeah, the people are certainly getting their money's worth tonight. And you want an all-star game to be entertaining, and this certainly has been all that and more.
Of course, stay with us, folks. Here at halftime, we will have for you the Queen of Queens presentation and also the McDonald's All-Star Band performance as well. And, you know, Tom, we mentioned it going into this game, but we saw it there as well in the first half. Turnovers really played the key. Both teams scored their touchdowns off of a turnover from the other team.
Yeah, West Virginia has moved the football, but as you said, the benefit of that turnover was key, and the same with Ohio. So you're going to expect that. There's going to be mistakes in an all-star game, and both teams took advantage of it.
And we see the Queens making their way out here onto the field at Wheeling Island Stadium. And we will be going down to the field level to hear the announcement of the Queen of Queens and see who our place winners are for this year. I know their competition was held on Thursday night at the Capitol Theater in downtown Wheeling, and a great part of this game and the pageantry of this game is the Queen of Queens competition, and it's great to see this many people involved once again.
Unfortunately, with the COVID restrictions, several of the schools were unable to have their competition. So
correct.
A little shorthand this year. Usually they expect about 25 girls, so, but a great turnout, and these young ladies give it their all, and just a great addition to the OVAC All-Star Game.
Yeah, it's just part of it, and again, it's something that you look forward to, and it really just adds to the entire week and really to the entire game atmosphere as well. Our Dalton Haas is down on the field. We'll be going to him here momentarily, and he will be announcing the winners of this year's Queen of Queens competition. I've had the chance for many years to be the host of the Queen of Queens competition at Wheeling Park, but this year, due to COVID, I was not able to do that because of the COVID situations and the way we held the competition at Wheeling Park High School. But I was I've always been proud to be a part of that, and it's always a wonderful performance. And I really enjoy being a part of that as well in my time. And really a pretty good crowd on hand here tonight. We see some of the folks here that are enjoying the game here tonight. We're glad you're joining us as well here all along the way on WTRF.com or on the WTRF 7 News Facebook page. And we're happy to have been able to bring you this game this year. It's exciting for both of us, Tom and I, with the opportunity. We've called a lot of high school football games in the year, Bear, but it's the first time I've had the chance to call the All-Star football game.
Absolutely. I've had the pleasure of officiating a few of them, but the first time I've been on this end of the mic, and it's a great experience.
Okay. And we're going to be going down to our Dalton Haas in just a few seconds, and he is down on the stadium.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Dalton Haas, and welcome to Wheeling Island Stadium. Ladies and gentlemen, it's time to crown your 2021 Queen of Queens. Presenting the Miss Congeniality Award, JT Thomas, the physical therapy specialist of WVU Medicine of Wheeling Hospital. Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Congeniality. From Edison Local High School, Miss Emma Scott. Presenting the fourth runner-up, Tammy Sechrist, the Executive Director of Marketing and Brand Management of West Liberty University. The fourth runner-up, from St. Clairsville High School, Miss Bella Swan.
I gotta turn it up now, you can't even hear me.
Presenting the third runner-up, Mr. Eric Petho, Director of Health Management Solutions and Paramount Preferred Solutions. From Wheeling Central Catholic High School, Miss Brianna Coughlin. Runner-up, Mr. Scott Holt, representing Bordas and Bordas. From the Lindsley School, Miss Cindy Glessner. Presenting the first runner-up, Brooke Stahl from Belmont College. From Wheeling Park High School, Miss Amanda McGovern. Gentlemen, presenting the 2021 Queen of Queen Award, Miss Stephanie Grove from St. Clairsville, Ohio Valley Mall Branch, manager of Huntington Bank, and Chief Rabban Jeff Hawkins of the Shriners Osiris Temple in Wheeling, presenting on behalf of the illustrious potentate John Paglilunga. Ladies and gentlemen, your 2021 Queen of Queens. From Barnesville High School, Miss Alana Trigg. Ladies and gentlemen, the AAC would like to thank the accounting firm of Kazicki, Hughes, and Tickerhoof for tallying the Queen of Queens scores. Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause for all of our Queen of Queen candidates.
Well, congratulations to Barnesville's Alana Trigg. She is your 2021 Queen of Queens from Barnesville High School. Another great part, as we said, of the OVAC All-Star football game, the halftime portion, of course, Queen of Queens. Queens were invited to come back to this game here tonight, and they were recognized earlier in the game during the first quarter of the game. They were brought out onto the field and were recognized here to the crowd. Of course, now that's not the same thing. It's not like playing in the game, but boy, at least it was doing something and still recognizing those young people. Job with that as well. So I look forward to
more normality now,
if you will. And this
listen
is
to them
one
now,
of those things of normalcy is the OVAC All-Star Football game.
We're halftime here.
Seeing the young ladies here participating in the annual Queen of Queens competition is yet another part of that, too. So great to have them here, and great to see these young ladies being honored here tonight at Wheeling Island Stadium. And again, congratulations goes out to Barnesville's Alana Trigg, who is this year's OVAC Queen of Queens. And now coming up, folks, we're going to have the McDonald's OVAC All-Star Marching Band performing here at halftime at Wheeling Island Stadium. So should be a wonderful performance from them. We got to hear from them during the pregame as well when they performed the fight songs for both schools and pro states, that is, and then also performed the national anthem. They did an outstanding job with that as well. So I look forward to having the chance to listen to them now here at halftime and view their performance too. Again, we're at halftime here of the 75th annual Rudy Mumley OVAC All-Star Charity Football Game. West Virginia leads Ohio 10-6, but it's now time to listen to the OVAC
Ladies
McDonald's All-Star
gentlemen,
Band. Here they are.
Under the direction of Rosalind Thacker, assisted by Rick Hicks,
Kim Manning and Alicia Fletcher. Auxiliary directors, Sarah Mattioli, Alex Grafton, Maya Neary, and Liza Jones. The band is led on the field by Jaden Collins from Weir High School. We proudly present the 2021 OVAC All-Star Marching Band.
By the Steubenville Big Red Dance Committee and a percussion feature by Eliza Fletcher. Stand up and dance along to Lady Gaga, Born This Way.
Thank you.
You gotta be cool, relax, get hip, because the OVAC band is ready to play this Queen hit, Crazy Little Thing Called Love. As we celebrate our OVAC queens tonight, we crown Katy Perry as the final queen of our show. Listen for the surprise twist at the end of Roar.
Thank you.
ready, West Virginia fans.
For the first time, the OVAC All-Star Marching Band will be performing the whole entire show again to you.
Well, you heard that right, folks. So if you missed any of the performance so far, good news. You're going to get a chance to see it once again coming up here as the McDonald's OVAC All-Star Band will now flip the field, and they will be performing to the West Virginia side of the stadium. So opportunity for the West Virginia band members to play to their side of the stadium now here at Wheeling Island Stadium. And again, we continue here at halftime where West Virginia leads Ohio 10-6 in the 75th Rudy Mumley OVAC All-Star football game. Second half is coming up. First, we still have more from the McDonald's All-Star Band.
Tonight, we are going to have a real good time as the band presents this classic Queen hit, Don't Stop Me Now. Featuring our auxiliary line, you can't have a Queen show without this jam. You're going to love our version of Fat Bottom Girl. This Queen show includes Queens of Pop. Our next chart will feature a dance written and taught by the Steubenville Big Red Dance Committee and a percussion feature by Alicia Fletcher. Stand up and dance along to Lady Gaga, Born This Way. You gotta be cool, relax, get hip, because the OVAC band is ready to play this Queen hit, Crazy Little Thing Called Love. As we celebrate our OVAC queens tonight, we crown Katy Perry as the final queen of our show. Listen for the surprise twist at the end of Roar.
Hey fans, the Russell K. Armstrong Memorial Scholarship is given in memory of Russ Armstrong, band director of Martins Ferry High School for 30 years and the assistant band director at Buckeye Local High School for 20. Mr. Armstrong directed and assisted with the OVAC All-Star Band on several occasions. The scholarship is being presented by his wife, Mrs. Suzanne Armstrong, along with Bill Stevens of Buckeye Local High School and Ben and Amanda McPherson of the OVAC. The 2021 winner of the Russell K. Armstrong Scholarship is... Sydney Filonis.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, McDonald's would like to proudly recognize the OVAC All-Star Band Scholarship winner for 2021. As a longtime supporter of the band, McDonald's of the OVAC would like to award this year's scholarship. Jaden Collins. Presenting the award tonight is Melissa Cheo from CA House Music. Jaden, please step forward. Ladies and gentlemen, nice round of applause for the 2021 McDonald's OVAC All-Star Marching Band.
There you have it, the McDonald's OVAC All-Star Band. Great performance by them here at halftime at Wheeling Island Stadium. Scott Oldie, Tom Bechtel back with you. We're getting ready for the second half of the football game here. Put 3 minutes on the clock and let the players come out and do a little stretch and a little warm-up, and we'll be ready for second half action. And, Bear, you got to be ready for something like that. This is the longest halftime any of these guys have ever had to go through.
Yeah, quite an adjustment. I know just from refereeing this game on four occasions, it's actually a tale of two games. You know, you play a game,
yeah,
then you take a break, or a semi-game, if you will, take a long break, and then play another game. So it's really tough for the kids. They got to adjust, and, you know, whatever momentum, although I don't know that anybody had momentum at the end of that half, but, you know, you got to regroup and come back out, and it's, like you said, it's a whole new ball game.
That's a great way of putting it, is you are kind of playing two separate games, really, because you got to come out, you got to go through your warm-ups once again, and you've got to go ahead and get yourself prepared to go ahead and play this game. Hey, let's go back down to the sidelines, and our Dalton Hawes is there with Mr. Ross Stoltz from McDonald's. Dalton?
Hi, fans. I'm Dalton Hawes. Joining me is Ross Stoltz, owner and operator of several area McDonald's in the Upper Ohio Valley. It is hard to believe that this summer marks nearly 40 years that McDonald's has sponsored the All-Star Marching Band. Mr. Stoltz, what did you think about the performance during the halftime?
I thought it was great, and they outperformed because they had to do it three times.
And Mr. Stoltz, what brings you so much joy to sponsor the All-Star Marching Band?
Well, we enjoy
all the folks from McDonald's for their support of the OVAC Marching Band as well, and great support from them, their family, and from so many others. Help make this happen, and the OVAC McDonald's All-Star Band, just another great part of halftime here at Wheeling Island Stadium, and a part of the atmosphere. I mean, it's one of the things that I truly like so much about high school and college football are the bands, and just what it adds to the atmosphere and to the action, if you will, on and off the field.
Scott, the biggest disappointment in my officiating career is the fact that when I started, every school had a band. They were very entertaining, and unfortunately through the years, that's no longer the case, and it's really nice when you do get to see us. And we do have some outstanding bands in Ohio Valley, and it's good when you get to see them, but unfortunately, it's fewer and fewer times that you get to see that in this day and age.
And I believe Dalton's standing by with yet another one of our sponsors of the All-Star Band as well. Let's go back down to the sideline and Dalton Haas. Dalton?
Hi, fans. Joining me on the sidelines is Melissa Cheo from CA House Music. CA House Music is a brand new sponsor of the OVAC. And with this new partnership, how can you help our OVAC member schools?
Well, you know, music is so important in our community and especially in our schools. And the opportunity for these students to participate in this band. I know it's absolutely a confidence builder. It shows everybody, I mean, that halftime show is amazing, and it shows everyone how hard these kids work. And we are so grateful to be part of this and just help the kids shine because they work so hard. So.
Well, on behalf of the OVAC, we thank you for being a major partner, and we look forward to you sponsoring us next year. Thank you.
All right, Dalton, thank you, and thank you to CAA House Music as well for their support. Hey, I think we have some first half highlights that we might be able to get through real quick. The three scoring plays that we had from the opening half right before we get to the kickoff here for the second half of Wheeling Island Stadium. Of course, the scoring got started on a field goal from Joe Lima from Lindsley that got West Virginia on the scoreboard first, and that would give them an early 3-0 lead as he would knock a 40-yard field goal that got the scoring started. And then really the rest of the scoring, Tom, came from the defensive side, if you will. West Virginia's only touchdown was a fumble recovery for a touchdown, and Ohio, an interception that led to their touchdown in the first half.
Yeah, that first field goal was key. They had a little three-minute scoring drive and knocked down a 40-yarder.
Lima with the kick as we get started here for the second half, and guess who? It's Dylan Moore from Beaver Local. Moore with plenty of room. Dylan Moore is at midfield and finally taken out of bounds at the West Virginia 44-yard line. What a great return from Dylan Moore as he sets Ohio up with fantastic field position to get this second half started.
I certainly find a way to kick the ball away from him. He is Mr. Excitement, and
he has gotten it done for Team Ohio tonight, that's for sure. On the Belmont College replay, you see it here, and it's a good job of avoiding contact, misdirection, and good speed, too, that Moore showed. But we had a penalty on the return. It always seems to happen when you have a really good return, doesn't it? And it's always well down the field as well.
Yeah, that negated about a 51-yard run back.
Yeah, so instead of being in West Virginia territory at about the 44-yard line, they'll start from their own 16-yard line.
And as we said, penalties and mistakes are obviously the key to any All-Star game.
So Ohio now starts deep in their own end. Ball's on the 16-yard line. They trail 10-6 here. As you check that out on our Huntington Bank scoreboard. And starting the second half, the quarterback will be Barnesville's Aiden Hannes. Of course, he had an outstanding career with the Rocks, not only in football, but baseball as well. And a pickoff. His first pass is intercepted. Shahid Jackson from Wheeling Park takes it back for a pick six.
My man Heba, the littlest one of the littlest fellows on the field, came up with a huge interception. And the Park fans have seen this before.
Great speed from Shahid Jackson, too. Didn't really have to use his speed much there, but you'll see it here. First play of scrimmage in the second half. Hannes looking to throw, and right there is Jackson trying to get it to Evan Carpenter. And then Jackson made one man miss, and he's into the end zone for a touchdown for West Virginia.
I'll tell you, that's a nice catch. And once again, another versatile athlete. Junior high, he wrestled, he played basketball, he played football, he played baseball.
Right.
A man for all seasons. And
he was a football, basketball, and track athlete during his times at Wheeling Park High School. Here's Lehman now on for the point after. The kick is up, and it is good. And so West Virginia extends their lead. They now lead 17-6. Over Ohio with 11:42 to go here in the third quarter. We're just getting started. We've already had some fireworks here.
Yeah, it's been a very entertaining game, and defense coordinator James Wallace said we need to create some turnovers, and they've created them in a big way with two touchdowns.
I mean, can you ask for much more from your defensive side than to get two turnovers, number one, but both of them you turn instantly into scores?
Yeah, the offense didn't have to do any work, and two big touchdowns on the board. So
17-6, excuse me, on our Huntington Bank scoreboard here. We're just 18 seconds into the second half here at Wheeling Island Stadium. Not the way, if you're Aiden Hannes and Team Ohio, that you wanted to come out and get things started. You saw what they were trying to do, just trying to run a little flare out to Carpenter out of the backfield, get him in some open field and see what he could do. And boy, Jackson smelled that the whole way.
Yeah, and I think a lot of this is based on the fact West Virginia has fairly well shut down the running game from the Ohio All-Stars.
Absolutely.
They had the one big run by
Schaefer. Yeah, where they were deep in their own end, and he busted it for about 30 yards. But other than that,
they've only got about 30 or 40 yards running. Of course, West Virginia, conversely, I think they had 12 yards rushing from their running backs in the first half. Of course, many negative yards with the sacks. So
but they are getting the passing yards that they knew they had to get to try to move the ball, although their offense has only scored 3 points so far in this game.
Absolutely.
There's Lima. Oh, he's going to do a little short kick, and Reese Skaggs is able to get right on top of it there. Good hands from Skaggs. Good athlete, tight end on offense as well, so he's handled the football before. That was excellent play on his part. And how about that from B.J. DePue? Maybe we get the ball right back again.
Yeah, I'm not sure there was an onside kick, though, Scott. He really didn't kick it like he was trying to.
It's almost more like a direct, like they were trying to maybe bounce it off of him or you know, some kind of direct kick to get a fumble or a turnover. But
of course, pretty wise move to keep away from Moore.
Well, that's true, too. So it's first and 10 for Ohio. Ball is on their own 46-yard line. Hannes will hand it off, and good running room here for guess who? Matt Schaefer for, or no, excuse me, that was number 8, not 9. That's Briar Portman from Shenandoah. And Portman takes it all the way down to the West Virginia 34-yard line. Portman with a nice run here. You'll see it again on our Belmont College replay. Bounces off one tackler. Looks like he might have lost the ball late. Now he held on to it. So it was a helmet
the
that
helmet
was
flew
lost.
Out there, yeah.
Yeah. That was Steve Felton who lost his helmet, middle linebacker for West Virginia. So Hannes under center now, first and 10. They'll do some motion, and they'll give the ball to Carpenter. And not much running room there that time, as it was Demetrius DeShield and Kyler O'Connor once again in on the tackle for West Virginia. DeShield and O'Connor have made a number of tackles up front, and they're really part of the reason why Ohio's not had a lot of success running the ball straight ahead.
Well, the coach has said if you can hear O'Connor's name called out, that our defense is going to do well, and so far tonight that's been true.
So it's second down and 8, gain of 2 on first down. Hannes under center. Motion, that's Schaefer. They'll give him the ball this time. Schaefer around the end, gets a nice block, and Schaefer still on his feet. Carrying a tackler all the way down inside the 15-yard line. And they're going to mark him down. Well, they'll say he stepped out of bounds at around the 17-yard line.
Scott, it appears Ohio's elected to go with that wing tee after that errant pass down there resulted in a touchdown. Looks like now they're going to commit to the wing tee and see what they can do.
Well, right now what they're doing is moving the ball deep into West Virginia territory, as they have it first and 10 on the West Virginia 17-yard line. Carpenter again is the tailback. Hannes at quarterback. Dozier and Schaefer are the wingbacks. The give is to Carpenter, and again, boy, not much happening at all inside, and there's O'Connor again with the tackle for West Virginia. And DeShield was one of the other defenders that was also in on that play.
Patterson also came out from his defensive safety position to help out.
I think we've seen in this game already why Oak Glen had such good success these last several years, because we've called O'Connor's name a number of times and Gage Patterson's name a number of times, and they still have a number of players that will be returning to play as well next year for
the
Golden Bears.
They had an outstanding team, and there's two reasons
they've
right there.
They've had a great run over these last several years, that's for sure. Here's a little inside handoff this time, and Schaefer, not a whole lot of running room, as he gets maybe just a couple of yards. Jason Beisel came out of the pile with the football there, but he was already down.
I see
it's going to be third and 10, Tom.
Jordan Waterhouse is on the defense side of the ball now, made an assist on that tackle.
Waterhouse played both sides of the ball, obviously, for Wheeling Central. Excellent athlete. He'll continue his career. He's going to Denison to play college football.
Of course, he's another one, has a few connections, a couple
yes, he does.
Uncles of
two
his.
Two uncles that both played in this
Greg,
game.
Greg DeLeg played back in 1979, Kleppner, and, of course,
yep.
Uncle Jerry Ames.
Here's Hannes. He's just going to keep it himself and trying to get out and around, and he'll get away from the initial tackle, and then we'll get down to about the 12-yard line. He's going to be a little bit short. I think Ohio thought there could have been a flag there for a late hit out of bounds. Let's check it again here on our Belmont College instant replay. You see Felton gets him there. When he's on the white, then he's hit again and then taken to the turf, and you could have maybe seen something. It was Marco Apery with the tackle for West Virginia, but no flag comes out, so it's now fourth down and 5. Ball is on the 12-yard line. They need the 7 for a first down.
Obviously, it's real still early, but
maybe a field goal, but they're going to elect to go for it instead.
Big play right here.
So can Ohio pick up 5 yards and a first down? Here's Schaefer trying to get around the corner. Schaefer, yes, he will get the first down as he stretches out and gets it down to about the 5-yard line. And boy, he's been their go-to guy when they need a play offensively to run the ball. It has been Matt Schaefer out of Indian Creek that has really been the man to get the job done.
Yeah, nice little case of misdirection there. Play appeared to be going right, and Schaefer certainly a capable ball carrier.
So it's first and goal now for Ohio. as they have it with 9:05 remaining here in the third quarter. Same setup, two wings, there's motion. The give is to Carpenter, and not much happening again. He gets about a yard, maybe two down to the three. But again, on this part of the field, that's not a bad carry because you got 2 yards and now only three more to go to get into the end zone. But again, Kruda in there at tackle, and also the other guys that we've mentioned so many times tonight, DeShield, O'Connor, doing an excellent job along that defensive front for West Virginia.
Yeah, that defensive front four for West Virginia has been solid throughout the game.
Motion again, and they'll give it to the motion man, but not much happened in that time. Mm-hmm. West Virginia did a great job to really stretch it out, and Briar Portman not able to turn the ball upfield, and he's taken down. It looks like, for no gain or a loss, they're going to give him a loss back to the four-yard line, so it's going to be third and goal now.
Coach DePue and defensive coordinator Wallace really got to like the pursuit of this defense. Each and every tackle, there appears to be three or four guys grabbing at the ball carrier.
They are running to the football, that's for sure. And as you said, great pursuit from sideline to sideline for the West Virginia defense. So third down, third and goal from the four. We're early in the third quarter. West Virginia leads 17-6. Hannes rolling, pressured, and Hannes coming back, throwing to the end zone. No, short of the end zone, but pulled in and caught. And so it'll be fourth and goal now from about the 2 yard line.
Is that Portman on the catch?
That was Schaefer who makes the catch. And it looked like when he originally was going to catch it, I thought he might have a chance to turn it up and score. But the ball was taking him to the sideline, so he goes out of bounds at the two.
Okay, let's watch this replay. Credit Aiden Hannes did a great job. Just to stay alive and make that play happen. And that's a pickup of a big 2 yards.
Huge, just to keep the drive alive, because that could have been disastrous if he sacked back around by the 15 or 20-yard line. Well, where do you go here if you're Ohio? The wing handoff to Schaefer has worked well, but now they're going to go with a full house backfield here.
I think they got the big guy in there, 27,
and they're going to
McCartney.
Hand it off to Balgo, and he is stopped. Will Balgo stop shy of the goal line at the 1 yard line? Ohio will turn the ball over on downs. Well, that West Virginia front defensively has just been outstanding tonight. We knew that would be a key moment of the part of this game, but you mentioned that in the keys to the game in the opening tonight.
That was the big package that Eric Huck talked about. That was a huge backfield
there. Yes, it was.
McCartney, the big 275-pounder from Steubenville, was in there. He stays in on the defensive front line. And, of course, Balgo and Carpenter. That's three pretty healthy-sized running backs.
Yes, they are. My goodness.
You won't see a backfield this side of the pros that big.
But West Virginia doing an excellent job defensively up front. But now they're lined up by their own goal line here. Anthony DeMattis is the quarterback now, and he's just going to hand the ball off. And Crudup gets out of there. How about Crudup taking the handoff? And DeAndre Crudup picks up huge yardage for West Virginia and a first down. All right, let's go back down to the sideline and Dalton Haas, who's with yet another one of our sponsors. Dalton.
First down. Ball on the 12-yard line.
All right, not much happening there for Team West Virginia on first down from the 12-yard line. But, boy, on that run by Crudup, what came to my mind was West Virginia's had some success. Not a whole lot, but running the ball up the middle a few times. And that's not what you've been able to see from Ohio as they face this West Virginia defensive front. That was an excellent effort on his part.
And let's credit Anthony DeMattis. Come in here for a couple plays, got the big handoff. And they said they would use him as quarterback in short yardage situations. Well, this is a reverse short yardage situation.
Yeah, Heller is back in there now. And they'll go back to their wide set. Get away from what was their heavy set, if you will. Stevie Mitchell is the tailback. Three wideouts to the near side on second and about eight. Heller, that looked like a busted play for sure. And he's going to be tackled right at about the 15-yard line. So it's going to set up third down and seven now for West Virginia. 5 minutes. And about 8 seconds on a turning clock here in the third quarter of play. West Virginia leads Ohio 17-6. A Again, trips to the near side for West Virginia on third and seven. Here's Heller from the gun. He'll roll the pocket to the near side, looking downfield. And his pass is going to be too high and out of bounds, intended for Carson Namak. And West Virginia will be forced to punt.
Nice coverage on that play by Jordan Joseph.
Yeah, great job by Ohio that time to come out. Even after giving up the first big surge play that got them out of the inside their own five-yard line. But then Ohio really tightened up and forces West Virginia to have to punt once again.
If you're West Virginia, though, you got to feel good. You ate up about a half of the quarter there.
We'll see if Jordan Waterhouse can get off another one of his booming punts here. Stands at his own three. And he'll boot it out to about the 45, but look out. Good running room here and good return room for Moore. He's at the 35 and finally knocked out of bounds inside the 30 at about the 28-yard line. That was just a sprint once he got the football. And, boy, Dylan Moore continues to impress.
Yeah, I think you cannot kick the ball to Dylan Moore. I think West Virginia needs to learn that lesson.
Yeah, kick it, punt it away from Moore. And you might have a little bit more success. They're going to say he was down to the 26-yard line before he officially was marked out of bounds. So 4 minutes, 37 seconds left to go here in the third quarter. West Virginia still up by 11, 17-6. Here's Ohio with the ball. Hannes is still in at quarterback. Hannes going down deep over the middle, and no, towards the pylon, and it's incomplete. He was trying to get it to Moore, but a lot of pressure once again on Hannes. West Virginia's defensive effort has been strong in terms of pressuring the quarterback in this game tonight. We saw Tonkovich pressured at times, Gorman, and now Hannes as well.
Yeah, this has been a quality defensive effort by the entire West Virginia team. Like you said, giving up a lot in terms of size on that line of scrimmage, but they've been hanging tough and great pursuit of the football.
West Virginia trying to snap a two-game losing streak in this series. Before that, they had won three straight. Here's the handoff coming back to Schaefer again. He looks to cut back into the middle. Excuse me, that's Portman. 9-8 looks so familiar, similar to me there, Tom.
A little tough from up here.
Breyer Portman was the ball carrier out of Shenandoah. He'll pick up about 5 yards. So it's going to be third and five now for Ohio from the West Virginia 21-yard line.
That's the great thing about the UVC All-Star game. These players from these smaller schools like Shenandoah get a chance to stack up against the big boys, and obviously there's some outstanding football players on that level, too.
Let's see what Ohio can do here on third and five from the West Virginia 21. Still trailing by 11. Oh, a little reverse here, and I thought it looked like they might be looking to throw the ball, but Dozier turns it back up inside and really for a gain of maybe about 2 yards. It's going to be fourth down and about three for Ohio now from the West Virginia 20-yard line. Maybe closer to four. Third and a long three, short four. Ohio will go for it once again. West Virginia's defense has been strong in these situations. See what they can do here on fourth and four from the 20. Hannes is in the gun. He has Carpenter to his side. Hannes will look to throw the ball back to the near side. He's got Skaggs there. He makes the catch, but what a tackle by Dalton Flowers of John Marshall, who comes up and takes the legs out of Skaggs before he's able to turn the ball upfield.
Of course, Dalton, real well known for his offensive abilities throughout his high school career, shows right there he can step up pretty big on the defensive side of the football.
They had Skaggs over there, and he was open, and if they could have gotten a block on Flowers, that's a first down, I think, for sure. Now let's go ahead and take a break, folks, with 3:06 remaining here in the third quarter, and West Virginia leading 17-6. We'll be back with more of the 75th Annual Rudy Mumley OVAC All-Star Football Game.
We're doing exciting things at W. Heart and Vascular Institute in advanced heart failure, in valvular heart disease, in atrial fibrillation, and even heart transplantation. We know that if patients can achieve advanced care in their home community, they do better. We provide the entire spectrum of care, and our outcomes are amongst the best in the nation.
Visit mywvuheart.com. These days, college takes more time and money. If you go to public high school in Ohio, you can take college courses at Belmont College for free. With each course, you earn high school and college credit. You can apply those credits to a degree from Belmont, transfer them to a four-year school, even graduate from high school in Belmont at the same time. With College Credit Plus at Belmont College, you'll save time and money. That's why Alyssa chose Belmont. Earn college credits in high school at Belmont College.
Introducing Standby Cash. Extra cash when you need it. Free when you auto-pay it back. New when you bank with Huntington.
And we're back at Wheeling Island Stadium. 3:06 remaining here in the third quarter. West Virginia is leading Ohio 17-6. And the 75th annual Rudy Mumley OVAC All-Star Charity Football Game here at Wheeling Island, and it's first down and 10 for West Virginia after the stop on fourth down on their own 21-yard line. Heller, little mix up in the backfield there, but gets the handoff that time to Alex Burton, I believe it was. Was that Burton or no? It was Aliki Barner of University.
The Golden Helmets, Scott.
Yep. Wasn't sure if that was Burton because John Marsh also wears those shiny gold helmets as well, but that was Barner out of U-High. Here's the snap again. And Heller to the air, has his receiver. Pass is caught, pulled in for a first down on the far side. And that's still trying to pick up extra yardage was Peyton Marling of Wheeling Central, but he's got enough for a West Virginia first down.
Once again, Bo Heller throws an extremely catchable ball. He puts it on the numbers, and all you got to do is put your two hands around and secure the football, and you've got a possession.
Saw the coaching staff from West Liberty University here on the sidelines earlier, and Bo, that's of course where Bo's going. They've got to be pretty pleased with the way he's performed in this game tonight. Toss out to Stevie Mitchell. Mitchell trying to turn it up inside, gets a couple of yards before he's finally taken down. Jake Visnick of Shadyside in on the tackle that time for Ohio, along with Mitchell Stokey of New Philadelphia, also helping to make the stop. Gain of about four. It'll be second and six now for West Virginia from their own 38-yard line.
Stokey, certainly a student athlete, going to take his collegiate career at Carnegie Mellon University.
West Virginia still getting the play from the sideline. Heller takes the snap, throws it out, and almost picked. That was nearly a pick six for Jake Rose.
For Peyton Marling.
For Ohio. Boy, Jake, that would have been a quick touchdown for the Buckeyes if Rose could have pulled that in.
I'll tell you, heavy pressure blitz by the Buckeyes linebackers, and Western Union very fortunate there to escape with just an incompletion.
Third down and six now for West Virginia. Ball's on their own 38-yard line. Yeah, twin wide receivers to the far side. Heller's in the gun. Mitchell's behind him. We got movement, or did Ohio jump offside? Let's see. I haven't heard much from Sam Jones this half.
No, he's been kind of quiet, thank goodness.
On the defense, number 87.
Going to set up a
five-yard penalty.
Third one situation.
Third down.
Yeah, so encroachment on the defense. And, yeah, boy, that changes things, doesn't it? You know, Ohio, you've got them in third and long, and now it's third and a yard to keep this drive alive. Heller again. He'll go out now again, and they're going to bring Kobe Hill again. We saw this in the first half, first time here in the second half. Hill in now, will take the snap, and Hill will look to run it. A lot of traffic, and nothing happened in Ohio. All over it that time. Great play defensively. Evan Carpenter was in on the stop for Ohio. Stokey was in there too. Visnick, they had that play read well.
Yeah, Kobe's elusive, but there was nowhere to run.
Fourth down.
So it's fourth down now and three, and West Virginia will be looking to punt once again. So in comes Jordan Waterhouse, and back goes Dylan Moore along with Brian Palmer. If I'm Waterhouse,
I'm kicking it towards the sideline.
I'm kicking it over to Palmer on the West Virginia sideline. And nope, here's Moore. No, he's going to let it bounce, and look out. Is that Beisel able to get it? Does he keep it out of the end zone? No, it went over the goal line. Went over the goal. You saw the speed from Beisel, who, by the way, was the Class A 100-meter champion from Magnolia High School this year. And great speed, and he showed that acceleration right there as well. He nearly kept that out of the end zone.
Yeah, the ball broke the plane of the goal line, which is the rule, and it'll come out to the 20.
Well, I was surprised that Moore let that bounce.
Really?
Just with what we've seen him do when the ball's in his hand. So.
Yeah, when he catches the ball, he's certainly electrifying.
You're West Virginia. That's a win, even though the ball was a touchback in the end zone, I think, because they're starting on their 20-yard line instead of more positive yardage. All right, so it's first and 10 for Ohio. Hannes will continue to stay in at quarterback for Ohio. Ball's on their 20-yard line. Now Hannes goes into the gun. And they'll hand it off in a fumble. Ball's on the turf. Breyer Portman able to recover it. And that loss will go all the way back to the 5-yard line. Jordan Bruick in there on the tackle for West Virginia, number 77 out of Weir High. Watch it again here on our Belmont College replay.
On the stop for West Virginia.
Marco Apri also helping to finish off the tackle there as well. A huge loss for Ohio. That's really what we've seen from Ohio tonight, unfortunately, are negative plays that have resulted into not just turnovers, but huge losses of yardage. And this, we'll see if they get this play off or not, Tom. You see the clock winding down here.
I might just wait.
No, they're going to snap it, and they'll give the handoff to Dozier. Dozier trying to get outside, and he won't get much at all. Boy, a strong tackle there on the far side by Anthony Sessi of Madonna. Just taking Dozier right down. And that's going to bring us to the end of the third quarter.
In favor of the All-Stars of West Virginia.
It's West Virginia leading 17-6 over Ohio. Hey, let's go back down to the sidelines. Our Dalton Haas is there with yet another of our fantastic sponsors, Dalton.
West Liberty University and CA House Music.
Management Solutions and Paramount Preferred Solutions are proud to be the exclusive workers' compensation.
So Bear will head to the fourth quarter here. West Virginia up by 2 scores, 17-6, so they lead by 11. Ohio's ball, third and long, third and 22 when we come back, on their own 8-yard line. And again, that West Virginia defense making plays. Yeah, so great pursuit again.
Yeah, kudos to James Wallace. I'll tell you, they've drawn up a nice plan, of course. The two big turnovers for touchdowns are huge.
Oh, absolutely.
But throughout the night, they've done a great job of containing this powerful Ohio offense. Really hasn't got their running game started like they had hoped to. West Virginia, conversely, negative yardage rushing the ball, and they're still ahead.
Yeah, so if you're Ohio, you're looking at this, you're thinking, we've held them to negative rushing yards, and we're down 11? Right? I mean, that's not what you would normally expect or think would be the case, but... That's where we're sitting with 12 minutes remaining here as we head into the fourth and final quarter from Wheeling Island Stadium of the 75th annual Rudy Mumley OVAC All-Star football game.
Well, let's be honest, Scott, the two turnovers for touchdowns have changed the total complexion
Absolutely.
Of this game.
This could be a 6-3 game, or it could still be a 3-0 game without any of the turnovers. Here's Hannes. He's going to look to pass, throw in the screen, has his man, and that's pulled in by Brian Palmer. And Palmer will get it up over the 20 to about the 21. It'll give them some room to punt the ball, but not enough for a first down. It's still going to be fourth down and close to about 8 yards. So they pick up some yardage to give them some room to punt, but that will be about it. And dropping back for West Virginia is going to be Wheeling Park's Stevie Mitchell. And he's going to stand at about his 40-yard line. The Chevalier will come in, the Warren local product, to punt the ball back to West Virginia. So another good defensive performance there by Team West Virginia and the Mountaineers. Chevalier with another good end-over-end punt. Mitchell catches it at the 39, looking for some room to run, and there is none at all. Great job on the coverage unit that time by Ohio as they're able to get down the field and make a quick tackle. Vincent Patron from Bel Air, number 50, was one of the first men in on that play for Ohio.
But most importantly for the youngsters out there, Mitchell did a great job of catching the football.
Yes.
Don't let it hit the turf and roll 30 yards. So that,
yeah, if you let that ball bounce, instead of having it on the 42, it might be back on your 20. So West Virginia leading 17-6. The only score we've had in this game in the third quarter came via an interception return for a touchdown by Wheeling Park's Shahid Jackson. It was on the first play of the third quarter. Nothing since then. So here we go with West Virginia on offense for the first time in the fourth quarter. Heller takes the snap, and he will hand it off to Mitchell. Not sure Mitchell was expecting the handoff. He had to take it anyways. Luckily, he was able to hold on to it, and that's going to be a loss of yardage for West Virginia, back inside the 40 to about the 38-yard line. Loss of four. And again, talking about that negative rushing yards for West Virginia.
There was a whole lot of red jerseys around that football.
I don't think Stevie Mitchell wanted to take that handoff. I don't blame him.
Yeah, he's fortunate he held on to it.
He was able to hold on to it, that's for sure. So it's now second and long, second and 14 for West Virginia from their own 38-yard line. Heller looking to take the snap. He does. Wants to throw it to Mitchell. Mitchell bobbles and somehow catches it. And he gets down to about the 40-yard line. And he looks like he might be dinged up a little bit here. I know some people thought maybe there should have been a flag for a late hit. There's going to be a timeout. Let's watch it again here. Mitchell just did a great job to catch the football. He's down there, and then you see a late hit that does come in. That could have probably been flagged for sure.
Yeah, most
definitely. And even to the fact that it looked like the hit went to the helmet. So
yeah, most definitely. That should have been a 15-yard penalty.
Luckily, Stevie's able to get up, makes his way off to the sideline, so he's okay. It's good to see that he made it to his own feet and gets off to the sideline on his own power. So Mitchell appears to be all right. No flag on the play, so that will mean it's third down now and 12, and that could have been a huge break for West Virginia. They'd have a first down and still have the football, but now they're facing third and long from their own 40-yard line. Just a great effort by Mitchell to even be able to catch the ball that time.
Yeah, that was a circus catch.
Here's Heller looking down over the middle part of the field, and it is almost intercepted. Aiden Hannis almost pulling it in. He had Kobe Hill, but he underthrows the ball a little bit, and Hannis nearly pulled that in.
Aiden, a very versatile athlete, been quarterbacking throughout the second half and shows up on the defensive end. He's going to play baseball in college at Muskingum, Scott. Yeah. So
an excellent baseball player as well.
Obviously a very well-rounded athlete.
Part of that Barnesville team that made it all the way to the state semifinals this year, played it up at Akron, and that was a fun team to watch, and they had a lot of great success. We got a flag on the play.
Backs.
Dead ball, illegal substitution on the offense, 12 players in the formation.
All right, so illegal substitution for West Virginia will march them back 5 yards. And they will now have the ball placed at the 35-yard line. That just makes it 4th and 17. Moore and Palmer back deep to receive again. Here's Waterhouse into punt for West Virginia. Waterhouse off the left foot. High end-over-end punt. Miller makes the catch. Makes the catch this time. And he's taken down pretty quickly that time by Felton at about the 40-yard line. So good decision that time, I think, on Moore's part to catch the ball because it got him positive yardage, but Felton a great job to fly down the field and make that tackle within 5 yards of him receiving the football. Well, here we go, Tom. I mean, we're down to 9:39 remaining. It's a two-score game for Ohio. They need to try to find some points here rather quickly, I would think.
Yeah, all of a sudden the clock's starting to become a factor.
So we start this drive, 9:39 remaining in the fourth quarter. Ball is on the Ohio 40-yard line. Aiden Hannis still in at quarterback. He'll send motion and fake the handoff and keep the ball himself. And Hannis, that something he's so apt to do when he was the quarterback for Barnesville, keep it himself and run it. And he'll pick up a few yards there.
Marco Apri on the tackle.
Yeah. Marco Apri. Apri's been all around the football as well tonight. We talked about on the Ohio side, but Apri's a guy that's made a number of tackles, along with Felton. The two Lindsley players have really made a number of important tackles for the West Virginia defense.
Yeah, when he lines up against those defensive or offensive tackles from Ohio, he's given up about 100 pounds to the man, but he's been strong in there.
Hannis under center gives it to Schaefer this time, and Schaefer's going to pick up enough yardage for the first down as he's able to get outside and takes it down to about the 46-yard line of West Virginia first down. You talk about Aiden Hannis at Barnesville. He threw for 2,545 yards and 24 touchdowns while also rushing for 300 yards and also had 308 yards receiving during his time at Barnesville. So let's talk about what kind of well-rounded athlete that young man is. I mean, it shows right there, and he was a great player for the Rocks in multiple sports. Stays in at quarterback here on first and 10, takes the snap, and he'll roll to the near side, looking to go to the air, and the pass is pulled in, and yes, caught. Ryan Palmer, he makes the catch. Palmer, who, by the way, is Buckeye Local's all-time leader in catches and yards, and actually has the most touchdowns in a single season for a Buckeye Local Panther, And he's a heck of an athlete, too. He was the Division III 152-pound state wrestling champion. And he's actually going to Baldwin and Wallace to both play football and to wrestle.
That's about as versatile as you get.
Right?
Yep.
So a big gain there on first down. Makes up second down and short. And they'll give the ball on the inside handoff that time. And a short carry goes for Carter Dennis of River. Haven't had a chance to call his name too much tonight, but Dennis, what a career he had for the Pilots and Mike Flannery's team down there in Hannibal. Picks up enough yardage for the first down. So it's first and 10, Ohio, on the West Virginia 33-yard line. Hannes puts Schaefer in motion. Double reverse. No, a triple reverse. Ball's on the field. And it's recovered by Ohio. Gary Kramer from Monroe Central is the man who was able to get back on top of that loose football for Ohio. So he went kind of with a triple reverse, it looked like.
Could have been disastrous.
You're Ohio. You're down to 7.5 minutes remaining. You put together a pretty good drive. You need points. You did not need a turnover, and luckily Kramer was able to get back on top of that for the Buckeyes.
Second and 16. Ball's at the 39.
So they lose about 6 yards. Because it's second and 16 now. Ball all the way back to the 39-yard line. Here's Hannes. Rolls to his left. Going downfield. Has a man wide open, and it is picked off. Intercepted. Gage Patterson somehow makes the catch. There were two Ohio receivers that were completely uncovered. Patterson shot the middle between the two and makes the interception. Watch it here on our replay from WVU Medicine.
I'll tell you, folks, keep an eye on this. This is a big-time play.
So you see Schaefer's open there. Yep. He's back with Palmer, I guess. Yep. Yeah, and he gets – I think he got both feet down.
Yeah.
Making a catch right here. First foot's down. He dragged the back foot, too.
Yep.
That'd have been a good catch in an NFL game. That was an excellent effort from Patterson. And he's turned in several big plays tonight for West Virginia.
Despite the fact both receivers appear to be open, he was keyed on the football, never took his eye off and came out with a big interception.
And another turnover for Team Ohio. That's at least their third that I count.
Yeah, that, the story of this football game has definitely been the turnovers.
West Virginia's turned the last two turnovers into points. Will they do it here? Hand off to Stevie Mitchell, looking for some running room. Nothing to be had there. Ohio all over him that time. Mitchell Stokey in on the tackle. Justin Bartlett from Cambridge, also there, number 17, to help make the tackle for Ohio, and a loss of 2 yards on first down for West Virginia.
If you're West Virginia, you'd love to run the football in this situation, but so far it's been nothing doing against this stout.
Yeah, you like to try to run the ball to run the clock, but Ohio's just been too good, really, when it comes to that. So it sets up second down and 12, ball in the 13. Here's Heller. He'll throw it back to the near side. There's Mitchell. Mitchell trying to get outside, stays on his feet, has some running room, and Stevie Mitchell takes it up to about the 22-yard line. Still going to set up a third down and about four for West Virginia. Let's go back down to the sidelines. Our Dalton Hawes with another interview with one of our fantastic sponsors. Dalton.
Fans, I'm Dalton Hawes. With me now is Scott Holt representing Bordas & Bordas Law Firm in Wheeling. Bordas & Bordas does a lot of great things for the OVAC, and one of those things is the Bordas & Bordas OVAC Football Scholarship. Scott, can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Yeah, it's a $1,000 scholarship that goes to an OVAC football player every season. Players on both sides of the river are eligible for it. One of the parts of the Bordas & Bordas Shield represents community, and so Bordas & Bordas is proud to do that because it's hard to represent community any better than all the communities of the Ohio Valley showing themselves here at the OVAC All-Star Game.
Absolutely, and at the conclusion of this game, we'll be handing out the Bordas & Bordas All-Star Football Game Cup. And will you be making that handoff to the winning coach?
Yeah, we'll be making that presentation to the winning coach. Looks good for West Virginia right now, but Bordas & Bordas has locations in St. Clairsville, Moundsville, and Wheeling, so we're on the winning side no matter what happens the rest of this game.
Absolutely. Well, we appreciate your sponsorship, and we look forward to the rest of the game here.
All right, thank you, Dalton, and we appreciate the folks from Bordas & Bordas as well. Former coach, Coach Holt.
Of course, a winning coach in his own right,
right?
Scott
yes,
Holt.
That's right.
Had great success at Cameron. And
yes, he did.
Was a pretty fair football player in his day. I'm positive he played in this game back a few years
ago.
Yes,
he did. I want to say 96.
That's probably about right.
I think that's right. That's just off the top of my head. So if I got it wrong, I apologize. While we were on the interview, you saw Heller complete a pass to Sincere Sinclair that went for a first down and then an incompletion on second on first down after that. It's now second and 10, and it's now going to be third and long. As Heller is just stacked up by a pair of defenders there. Luke Joswiak from St. Clairsville and also Justin Bartlett again from Ohio in to make the sack of Heller. And we've got a timeout on the field. All right, we got a timeout for our hydration break, and we're going to take the break as well. West Virginia still leads 17-6 with 5:55 remaining here in our game. Back with more of the fourth quarter right after this.
We're doing exciting things at the WU Heart and Vascular Institute in advanced heart failure, in valvular heart disease, in atrial fibrillation, and even heart transplantation. We know that if patients can achieve advanced care in their home community, they do better. We provide the entire spectrum of care, and our outcomes are amongst the best in the nation.
Visit mywvuheart.com.
When an emergency threatens, turn to the most experienced specialist in the area. With certified experts in every department, we're the local name to trust. Rely on our state-of-the-art diagnostic tools and years of experience. No crisis is too big or too small. We will help you perform your best. Put your problems in the hands of the experts. Choose CA House Music and play music for life.
Hey, you. Yeah, you. Have you registered for classes this fall at West Liberty University? Why not? You still have time. West Liberty University offers more than 70 majors with more than 30 undergraduate and graduate academic programs that are recognized nationally or have national accreditation. Plus, we award more than $6 million in scholarships annually. What are you waiting for? Classes begin August 23rd. Visit westliberty.edu/apply to get started.
Family Talk About Drinking is a program that helps parents talk to their kids about underage drinking. It's a community that allows parents to learn new ideas and ask questions about how to tackle the problem of underage drinking. Family Talk About Drinking, presented by WTOV9, the OVAC, and your local Anheuser-Busch distributors.
Now the OVAC Overall Champion Award presented by Wheeling Hospital is awarded to the OVAC member school that records the highest number of points in their respective divisions. All sports standings. Each high school is awarded points in predetermined number of sports for boys and girls. The winning school in each division receives a trophy and recognition during the Banquet of Champions in May. Standings can be found on the OVAC's official website. That's OVAC.org.
Another event we missed this year, Scott. That Banquet of Champions is always an outstanding event. Of course, you've hosted that for how many years?
Number of years. Yeah, we'll be happy to. Second straight year that we were not able to hold it in person at the arena. Looking forward to hopefully being able to do that next year. All right, here's West Virginia with a third and long. Heller over the middle, has a man, and it's pulled in and caught. That's Kobe Hill all the way down to the Ohio 42-yard line. How about that pass to Hill? That was on the money from Heller.
Once again, Kobe Hill came up early with some big catches, and here he is late. And it's a little too early to say it sealed the deal, but I'll tell you, it's going a long way towards the Western U victory.
I think West Virginia now would start to try to bleed the clock as much as possible and to try to run as much time off as they can. So it's first and 10. Heller running that play clock down. Ball is at the Ohio 42-yard line. Takes a snap with about 12 seconds to go on the clock. Heller forced from the pocket, and he will just throw it, and it's complete. Pulled in by Stevie Mitchell, a short pass that time, down to about the 38-yard line, but it's still a gain of 4 yards.
Yeah, a little 4-yard gain, but it keeps the clock rolling, and nice little completion.
Second down, and we'll call it about 6 now from the Ohio 38-yard line. You see the clock running down there on our Huntington Bank scoreboard. We're under 5 minutes remaining in this game. Ohio cannot afford to allow West Virginia to get another score here. They've got to keep them out of the end zone and try to do something offensively. So again, West Virginia running that play clock, down. And again, Heller will snap it as we're now under 10 seconds on the clock. And he hands the ball off, and trying to get outside is Shahid Jackson. And no way, says Aiden Hannes. Runs Jackson down. Boy, that was impressive from Aiden Hannes, because it looked like Jackson might have the opportunity to turn that up the field.
Yeah, Aiden had to come a long way from his defensive secondary position and the shorthanded tackle.
Keeps the clock running, though, again. And like you said, Tom, that's such a critical part right now as we're continuing to watch this time just dwindle away. We'll be under 4 minutes remaining in the game when we have our next play snapped.
Yeah, I think West Virginia would be content just to run another play here and punt the football. And
now, if you're Ohio and you stop them on third down, do you take a timeout? You have all three of your timeouts remaining. Do you try to? You want to try to extend the game as much as you can, right?
Certainly an option.
Here's Heller on third down and 9. He will hand the ball off to Waterhouse. Not much happening for Jordan. He stopped at the 40-yard line, maybe the 39, so a gain of only 1. It'll be fourth down and 8 for West Virginia. And Ohio, they are not taking a timeout yet. They're going to let the clock run here. So if you're West Virginia, you might take a delay of game penalty here.
Yeah.
Because the ball is at the 41-yard line. You kind of wouldn't mind having the extra 5 yards almost to punt, right?
Yeah, I wouldn't see any problem with a 5-yard penalty
here. Here's something
here.
Interesting. Waterhouse, who's been punting all night, is going off the field. So they're going to have, it looks like Joe Lima is going to be the man to come on and punt this one. It is. So Lima's going to come up, and he'll be punting. We're now under 3 minutes, 5 seconds on the play clock. And again, I think they might just take the penalty.
Hey,
let him get the snap off, and the punt was nearly blocked. But Lima gets it away. It's inside the 10, and will then take a right turn and be downed by Beisel. What a punt for West Virginia.
That took a fortuitous bounce. And,
you're not kidding.
Joe Lima with a nice kick.
So 2:42 now remaining in our fourth quarter of play, with West Virginia up 17-6. Well, the OVAC Museum is open for you, and we hope that you'll go and visit that. Of course, as we've told you, it's at West Banco Arena. And if you'd like more information, you can get a hold of Mr. Tom Ratajczak as well. And also, the OVAC reminds adults to discuss underage drinking. The Family Talk About Drinking is brought to you by Anheuser-Busch Distributors of the Upper Ohio Valley. And Karen Ballard Distributing, J.C. Mentor Distributing, Muxie Distributing Company, and Waldorf Distributing. So here's Ohio. They need points, and they need them fast, and we've got a penalty. See what happened here, Tom.
Offense, number 11, half the distance to the goal line, first half.
So a false start is the penalty against Ohio, so half the distance. We do not have the official numbers for penalties and things like that, but that's really been a key part to this game for Ohio, has been their penalties and the turnovers.
Yeah, that's
really been the key to their own misfortune.
Those essentially been the story of the evening.
Here's Tonkovich back in at quarterback. He'll give the handoff inside, and a short gain that time for Ohio. We'll go from Dozier as he'll move the ball
Garrett Dozier
out to about the 5-yard line, maybe to the 6, a gain of maybe, I don't know, a couple of yards as they were half the distance. So a gain of about 3 probably on the play. Second down now. Here's Tonkovich. He'll go to the air. Has a man. Pass is pulled in. That's going to be good for a first down. And the pass was caught that time by Carter Lose out of Union Local. First time we've had a chance to call Carter's name tonight. He did plenty of that for Bernie Thompson's Union Local Jets out in Morristown. Makes a catch there. See if they can get something going through the air here. Tonkovich again. He'll throw it up one more time. That's Dozier.
And that's Devin Gaines with a nice pursuit and tackle. That's back-to-back tackles.
When you looked
for
at
Devin.
Dozier there, he had a chance to maybe run out of bounds, right? I know he wants to try to turn it up. You're trying to get as much yardage as possible right now. But when you're running under 2 minutes, you need to stop the clock as much as you can.
Every second's critical.
They need to be able to go down the field a little bit more. Here's one to Palmer. He'll make the catch. Makes a couple of spins. Palmer will have the first down. There's a flag on the far side. There was some action going on between a defensive back and a receiver. And I don't know, we might have a personal foul penalty. We'll get it from Sam Jones here in a minute. We have a first down on the play for Ohio, but we might have additional yardage coming as well. It was all the way near the West Virginia sideline on the top.
Dead ball, personal foul on the defense, number 16. That's a 15-yard penalty, first down.
Boy, that's not what you need right now if you're West Virginia. That's on Shahid Jackson, who's made some big plays in this game. And he was locked up with a receiver from Ohio, but Boy, that puts the ball now at midfield with a minute 32 remaining, folks. We might have an exciting ending here for you. Here's Tonkovic again to the air. Pass is pulled in. That's Dylan Moore. And he'll have, it looks like, enough for another first down. So that'll stop the clock as they move the chains.
Here's a name we haven't called tonight much since Eric Sinclair. There's a reason. He's a shutdown corner.
Yes.
They haven't attacked him all night.
Unfortunately, the one time when he caught a pass, we were on an interview, but it did make a nice catch for West Virginia. Here's Tonkovic looking and just throwing it out of bounds. He was pressured that time, had to get rid of it, threw it near a receiver, but it'll go out of bounds. It'll stop the clock. It'll be second and 10 now for Ohio from the West Virginia 42-yard line. Looks like he was throwing it in the direction of Moore. I would probably do that as well if I was playing quarterback. Why not?
Really,
one chance of a positive play.
One of the keys tonight has been the cornerback play of the Mountaineers.
Yes.
They've been shut down. Jackson and Sinclair.
Yep.
They've been shut down like they were throughout their careers.
Here's Tonkovic and was going for Schaefer, who was just a little too tall for him. Kyler O'Connor was putting some pressure on Tonkovic that time. And so it's going to be third down and 10 now. Obviously, it's four down territory for everything for Team Ohio now with a minute 9 remaining. You see that on our Huntington Bank scoreboard. West Virginia leading by 11, 17-6. Tonkovic still in at quarterback, trips now to the far side for Ohio. Here's Tonkovic, takes the snap, looking downfield, has a man. Oh, my goodness. Moore was open and probably would have scored, and Sinclair nearly intercepted it after the deflection. If Moore catches that, he's probably into the end zone for an Ohio touchdown.
There's a lot of daylight. We'll take a look at it on here on the replay.
WVU Medicine replay will show us. I think he scores. Sinclair might have been able to run him down.
Yeah.
He has great speed as well. I would like to see that race to see who would have won that. But, boy, that's a missed big play
for
Ohio. And it's now fourth down.
That throw was just a little bit high, though. That would have been a tough catch.
It was. So it's now fourth down and 10. Tonkovic intended for Moore. Incomplete. Sinclair was on the coverage once again, and again it's an incomplete pass, and that will be a turnover on downs with 1 minute remaining in our game. Now, Ohio still has all three of their timeouts, but you would think this will probably be a situation where West Virginia can come out, kneel a few times, and they will take home the victory.
I like to call it the Vatican offense, a couple of genuflections, and we go home.
Oh, they see if they put Heller under center. I know even when Park would close out games late, they would still stay in the pistol or in the gun just because you're not used to taking those snaps under center.
That's true.
So still do it the way that you feel natural with. So with a win, West Virginia would snap a two-game losing streak in this series. Ohio had won the last two, and it would give West Virginia four wins in the last six games that had been played.
I'll tell you, shout out to both coaching staffs, two quality coaching staffs. Fort Fry obviously has had great success over the last 5 or 6 year period. And Lindsay, on the other hand, how about the schedule they're going to take on this year, Scott?
Oh, my goodness.
Unbelievable.
Yes.
And to DJ DePue's credit, he doesn't back down from those teams. He takes it as an opportunity. And, you know, quite frankly, they got 9 or 10 games that are each and one is going to be just a real tough ball
game.
You're
not kidding. You know, that's the thing that you have to worry about, too, in high school football is that, you know, when you start worrying about injuries and things like that, and when you're playing a difficult schedule like that week to week, that can be...
Well, and conversely, don't forget Fort Fry. I talked to their coaches.
Yes.
They have four playoff teams that reached the semifinals in the state of Ohio. St. Henry, Lima Central Catholic, a couple of their names escape me right now, but they have a monstrous schedule, and simply no one will play them. So
right. Both
these coaching staffs face through that, but, hey, they come out. They did a great job this week with the kids at camp, and... It's been a fun experience for everyone.
Sure has. This would be West Virginia's 29th win all time in the series. Ohio's won 45 of these games. Well, they'll bring out Anthony DeMattis here to help run out the clock.
Well, he's the short
yardage guy. They got Crudup in there as well, so they got some big backs in there. But I would suspect now they will hand it off. A little surprising to me. And they will allow a short gain, will Ohio, as Drake Huckel out of Brook.
Drake Huckel.
Huckel with the run there for West Virginia. So they'll gain a yard before Huckel is taken down. And Ohio will then use another timeout. So they're down to one remaining.
It's all over with the shouting, Scott.
Yeah, I think you're right, Tom. I mean, we're down to 53 and a half seconds left. You know, we mentioned this earlier, and I wanted to get back to this real quick while we have a chance, but we've talked about Cody Poe from 100. He's playing in this game. He's going to be joining the United States military. He's headed to the United States Army, originally enlisted in the Marines, but then felt like that just wasn't the perfect fit for him, changed his mind, and he's now going to enlist in the Army. Played his career for the 100 Hornets. Of course, they don't get a whole lot of publicity a lot of times. Small Wetzel County school. He had 415 tackles
in his career. That's incredible. That's incredible.
12 sacks, 8 forced fumbles. And even though he wasn't an offensive player much, he still scored 10 rushing touchdowns for him. His head coach is also his stepfather, DJ Bird. And he said it was his lifelong dream to be in the military. And he's just proud of him. Obviously, as a father, you would be very, very proud of your son. And congratulations to Cody Poe and DJ Bird as well, and the Bird family and the Poe family. And best of luck to him. And thank you to Cody Poe for going and representing and protecting our country.
There's a lot of great stories, and that's certainly one of the top ones right there, Scott.
So another timeout from Ohio, now with 46 seconds left to go. But I just wanted to make sure we got that on before we got out of here tonight. Tom, we were talking, too, about the father-sons that have all played in this. So Bo Heller, his dad Kevin Heller played in 91. Jake Rose from River. His dad Casey Rose played in 91. But Casey is also the uncle of Carter Dennis. And Jake and Carter, they're the nephews of Kyle Rose, who played in the game in 1990.
Absolutely. Silas McKeever, his dad Eric, played back in 96. He had an onside kick and interception back in that game. I'm sure he'll razz Silas about that. Of course, we already mentioned the Gormans, Will and Dan Balgo. Dan Balgo played back in 86. Of course, his son, Will, number 7, a pretty fair football player. And then, of course, we mentioned the Skaggs, Walt and Reese. So a lot of Reese, father-son connections.
And Reese and Reese's brother, Walt's other son, also played in this game. So there actually are 11 other players that are playing in this game tonight that have had relatives that have played in this game in the past. There's Beisel. And Bismick will take him down with the tackle, but he stays in bounds. Yes, how about that? 11 other players in this game, they have not their father, but they have relatives who played in this game. So at some point, do you think that, man, good athletes beget good athletes, I guess, right?
I've always been a believer in that.
And then we also talked about, of course, as you mentioned earlier, Gage Ryder. He is the 6th member of his family to have played in this OVAC All-Star
And I mentioned that
game.
Baseball connection. I don't know if I ever followed up on that. But Waterhouse, Bo Heller, Joel Joseph, Kobe Hill, Carson Namak, Hunter Kelly, who did not get a chance to play tonight, Steve Felton, Aiden Hannes, and Will Bago all played on the same travel baseball team from 9 to 14. And also on that team was my good buddy Dylan Gongola, who works for me. He's an outstanding baseball player headed to Fairmont State.
And he was a former football player, but gave that up in high school.
Will Carson is an outstanding soccer player down at IMG Academy down in Florida. And the Kish boy from St. C. I'm sorry, Colin, is it?
Yes.
The outstanding wrestler.
Yep.
So they had 13 or 14 boys, and they're all either college athletes or all-star football players. They were 9 for 9. 9 boys finished out their careers as football players. 9 of them made the all-star game. Shout out to James Carson and his crew.
Yes, sir. Pretty good golfer in his own right.
Yeah, he did fairly well for the Wolverines of Michigan.
I was going to say, he golfed for the university up north, right, that school up north. You're going to have to punt with West Virginia. Waterhouse will get it away, and he just elects to punt the ball out of bounds. And that's where it'll
Which
be
Which is a wise
out.
Decision yeah. by the House.
Absolutely. You don't want to give Moore a chance to do any damage with it.
I've seen House since he was a little baseball player, age 9.
Yep.
And this youngster was a skinny little baseball player. Now he's grown into be a man, and good luck to him with his career.
Yeah, headed up to Denison, as we told you. My wife had the chance to, was his principal when he was at Warwood Elementary School way back in the day, and she always still loves when she gets to see Jordan, and he's so kind and wonderful that every time he sees her, he still says, "Hello, Mrs. Nolte, how are you?"
Very polite young man.
Great young
man. I got to give a shout out to his grandfather, Jerry Ames Sr., who I refereed football with for many years.
Yep.
Soup is out there, and he's just so proud of his grandson.
Yep. And there's so many of those stories here with all these kids. I talked to a number of OVAC game officials before this game when we were down on the field, and they talked about just how well-behaved and gentlemanly these young men have been all week.
Well, shout out to the OVAC. You know, I think, I don't want to say they finally wised up, but at Bethany College, they have the teams housed in separate dorms. And that's a pretty good idea.
Absolutely.
You know, at West Liberty, sometimes they used to house them on separate floors, and it didn't always work out well. Sometimes the boys like to get a little...
I mean, look, it's...
Boys will be boys.
you're representing your state, and you're here to win. I mean, you know, so.
To a man, both coaches and all the coaching staffs said these kids were extremely well-behaved. They had a great week. They made a lot of new friends, and let's face it, that's what it's all about.
There we go. Gorman's at quarterback. He's going to go downfield, and that pass is going to be overthrown. Moore cut the route off. I think that's who they were looking for, but it's incomplete. And we still have 26 seconds remaining in this game. It was an honor for me to have the opportunity to call this game as well. I want to thank the OVAC for giving me this chance. And, Tom, it's great to be back in the booth once again with you. I always had so much fun when we did all our games together, and it was just a great experience tonight.
Well, it's been a blast. I appreciate you thinking of me, Scott, and it's always fun to watch high school football, and the All-Star game is the culmination of that.
You know, shout out to people like Dwayne Rogers from Wheeling Park High School helping to make this game happen as the Gorman's pass is incomplete, the great athletic director at Wheeling Park, and so many other folks that had to come together for this to get this broadcast done. Tony Wood from John Marshall, obviously the effort that he's done all night long as well, and the other volunteers that we have that are a part of this and getting this put together. It was just great that we were able to still broadcast this game and get it out there so people had the opportunity to watch and enjoy this great Ohio Valley spectacle.
Of all the OVAC events, and I've been involved in many of them, this is a tradition unlike any other, and it's a great experience for these football players, one they'll remember for the rest of their lives.
Here's Gorman again. This is third down and 10. He slipped. I think his knee did go down. Sam's on it. And that's probably going to be our final play because we're down to 13 seconds and under 10. And I think Ohio's just going to go ahead and run her out. West Virginia's already dumped the water bucket onto B.J. Depew. They're coming out to midfield, and that's the game, folks. Time runs out. West Virginia wins the 75th annual Rudy Mumley OVAC All-Star Football Game, 17-6 over Ohio. The teams meet here at midfield. And we'll have a little handshake here. Good sportsmanship, obviously. You know, so many of these guys, especially in today's day and age, it's crazy how this is, Bear. They all know each other.
Well, like you said, there's six kids from West Virginia, three from Ohio. They played baseball together for 6 or 7 years. They're the best of friends. They're not just friends. They're the best of friends.
Yeah. Yeah. They've played in how many out-of-town tournaments and, done.
And throughout each and every sport. Yeah, it's just.
Absolutely.
The world's changed so much, Scott. Back when I was a kid, the kids from Wheeling and Central didn't know each other. Nowadays.
And, of course, the social media just has changed everything so much.
Because, for sure. For sure.
You know, you see every athlete that you compete against, and, many times you didn't see them until you were actually there to play.
Exactly.
So congratulations to B.J. Depew as he picks up the win. And, of course, he was an assistant coach back in the day as well. And now has the opportunity to be a head coach and win this thing.
Let's give a shout-out to his dad, Terry Depew, one of the finest coaches ever to come through the I-Valley. And Lindsley and winning was synonymous with Terry Depew.
And, Tom, here's going to be our West Liberty University play of the game. It was the first play of the third quarter, the last score that we had, and really the play that sealed the deal for West Virginia. Aiden Hannes had his pass picked off by Shahid Jackson at about the 18-yard line, and Jackson turned it back upfield and able to take it into the end zone for the pick six and the touchdown. Both of West Virginia's touchdowns tonight coming on Ohio turnovers.
There's one proud football mom, Delvonda Jackson, former Wheeling Central basketball player. Shahid, of course, is her son, and there's no one prouder in the High Valley than her tonight.
Congratulations to Shahid. Congratulations to the West Virginia All-Stars as they get the win tonight. And, Jackson just made a great play on that. The other touchdown for West Virginia was a Kyler O'Connor fumble recovery for a touchdown. So that's how West Virginia got in the end zone both times. And Ohio's only touchdown came from a tipped interception that drive led to the touchdown. We're still waiting on, of course, the presentation of the Bordas and Bordas Cup that will be taking place down on the field. Of course, that'll be going to our winning head coach, Mr. B.J. Depew.
Bordas definitely has a connection to the game tonight. Carson Namak's mother is Kim Bordas, married to Benji, and Sincere Sinclair has lived with him for the last 4 years, so he's kind of like a stepson. So the Bordas and Bordas definitely had a direct impact upon this game tonight.
Yeah, wonderful family, and they do so much for the community, that's for sure. And are always great sponsors of a number of events. See Dirk DeCoy down there from the OVAC, Scott Holt. I see Doug Tush. now a member of the Lindsley coaching staff, used to coach, of course, at Bridgeport High School. His son, Trevin, was a great Lindsley athlete.
Would have been played in last year's game.
Let's listen in.
Representing Bordas and Bordas is Scott Holt. Presenting the Bordas and Bordas Cup to the coach of tonight's champions, Mr. B.J. Depew. His name will be added to the trophy, and it can be on display at the OVAC Museum at West Banco Arena until next year's game. Also representing the Ohio Valley Athletic Conference, Mr. Dirk McCoy. Congratulations, B.J. Depew, and the West Virginia All-Stars.
There you go. There's Coach Depew. And congratulations to him. And congratulations to West Virginia. And you know what? I like that addition because at least, Tom, it shows that, hey, we are playing for something, right?
Yeah, it's a very nice touch to the game. And credit the Bordas and Bordas, who's always supported the athletics in our valley. And
it's pretty neat, too, that now that will go into the Hall of Fame, as we told you, the museum at West Banco Arena, so you'd have a chance to go down there and you could visit that. And like you said earlier, I strongly urge anybody that's never had the opportunity, go there and visit it. It is an impressive spectacle. Congratulations to everybody that's involved with that. Doug Huff does a ton with that, I know. Tom Radizak, obviously, also as well. It's named in his honor, and I know that was a real dream of his to have that history that stays there and is alive for the Ohio Valley. The OVAC means so much to our area.
And, of course, the Hall of Fame induction, that's always a nice ceremony. So yep. The OVC does a lot of positive things, and we talk about all the different events and championships, and just a great conference, and under the capable leadership of Dirk Decoy.
Yep, Dirk's doing a wonderful job. Congratulations to him, too, on another well-run and well-executed event here tonight at Wheeling Island Stadium. You know a little something about championship events. I think you have one named in your honor,
well,
right?
don't bring that up, but no, we have a lot of fun with the softball.
You do a great job. Yeah, wonderful job. And it's another one of the great events. That's why I think as schools, you want to be involved in a conference like the OVAC, because there are those opportunities for all-star games like this, championship events. And that's really where the OVAC, and they've always talked about it, the kids, and the kids always come first.
I really enjoyed softball this year. We had a couple first-timer. Caldwell had never been in the event in the 40-year history of it.
Wow, yes.
They came down and won it with a young team. They'll be back. And in Connaughton Valley,
yes,
they've appeared at the tournament before but never won it. They won it, so it was great to see a couple of those teams that really participated in it. And I talked to the Fort Frye staff, and that was the one big item they said tonight. You need to participate in all the events, whether it be the All-Star game, the championships. You need to be an active OVAC member, and I hope that extends throughout the conference.
I do too.
We'd like to get New Philly and Dover. They're new members, but softball, they needed to be down here for the playoff. They had two outstanding teams, and we're going to work on that for future years. But I think they see here events like this are first class. You don't see all-star games like this too many places in the country.
No.
And, you know, the North-South game, and those are nice events, but they pale in comparison. The OVAC All-Star game is first class, and hats off. I mean, I was up there all week at the camp. Just a great job, extremely well organized. Dirk Fitch, we haven't said his name enough. He played in this game in 1979, and he has great memories, and that's why he is an outstanding game director. Of course, Bob Cook did a pretty fair job for years and years. But
Dirk's done a nice job taking
over. I'll tell you what, they picked a great guy in Dirk Fitch, because I'll tell you, he just loves this game, and it brings back memories for him, and he's enjoying it.
Looks like Bo Heller's enjoying himself there as well. And why not? He helped lead his team to a fantastic victory tonight. So for Tom Bechtel, I'm Scott Nolte. Thanks so much for watching the game tonight, and we appreciate the effort of everyone who was involved to help put this broadcast on here tonight from Wheeling Island Stadium. Once again, West Virginia wins the 75th annual Rudy Mumley OVAC All-Star Football Game 17-6. Good night, everybody, from Wheeling Island Stadium.